Okay, so next up we'll look at orthopedics and pain management. Mostly I'll be focusing on pain management. There's not a lot of drugs that are specifically used in the ortho section. It's not really part of the surgery realm as well. So we'll have like a surgery section a little bit later on in the semester. We'll talk about things like venothromboembolism because that is a big risk factor after orthopedic surgery. But you also see that postoperative pain and pain associated with orthopedic issues are a big deal. So this is kind of the area where we can talk about pain management and our opioids and different drugs like that. So pain management, how do you manage someone's pain? So this is a very, very common cause for patients coming in very common complaint. We know that this is a huge business. Lots and lots of money gets spent on pain relief and treating these patients. There's also a lot of loss of work and a lot of issues with people who are in so much pain that they cannot work effectively or they cannot have good quality of life. So a lot of your complaints are going to be pain. Here's how we need to be able to treat these guys. Some of the barriers that exist, there's lots of them, but really as far as related to the patient, a lot of patients will not take medications, especially opioids, because they are worried about addiction. They're also fearful of adverse effects that can occur. Lots of patients will be like, yeah, I had my wisdom teeth taken out and they gave me a prescription for Percocet, but I didn't take any of them. I just suffered through it because I don't want to get addicted to that stuff. Or they say, like, that stuff makes me feel totally crappy and I don't want to be on that, right? So a lot of patients will have their pain undertreated because they are worried about those concerns. Worried about or certain concerns with healthcare providers. So if you don't really have a lot of formal training on how to manage pain, you're not really equipped to handle some of the more kind of intensive nuances of dealing with that. You're also worried about governmental regulation, like if I'm over-prescribing, maybe the government's going to come and get me. Florida was a huge, huge issue for pill mills. Do you guys know what pill mills are? Mm-hmm. What are they? Yeah, so essentially we were one of the stops on the OxyContin Express, as they call it. So. Just for a little bit of reference, so basically there are a lot of people coming from Kentucky, Virginia type area. They would have buses filled with people. They would actually cart down here, and there were certain practices where physicians were writing for huge, huge numbers of opioids, just ridiculous amounts. And they had, they were probably in cahoots with some of these pharmacies that were saying 200 Percocet, absolutely, here you go. Or, whatever happens to be ridiculous doses, ridiculous amounts of drugs. They would take those back up into wherever they came from, and they end up selling them. And so, a couple years ago, government really cracked down on a lot of those pill mills. A lot of people went to jail. A lot of people had their licenses revoked. So there's some concerns with regulations regarding that. But obviously, these are people who are definitely breaking the law and not really trying to work within their actual their profession. But there's also fear of addiction as well. Like, if I prescribe some of these opioids to these patients, am I going to get them addicted? There's some legitimate concerns there. So we'll talk about addiction. We'll talk about tolerance and different things like that and how we can kind of delineate between those. And then related to the system, so certainly patients may have a lack of access. We have a lot of patients who have really significant chronic pain issues, and there's relatively few properly trained pain professionals or pain practitioners who have undergone training to know a lot about some of these other modalities. You shouldn't just throw opioids at every single problem out there. Maybe something like low-dose ketamine might be an option for them, or maybe other type of therapies they may not have thought about otherwise. Could be a lack of medication availability, and then also poor reimbursement for some of these services. So lots of barriers to why patients are not being treated appropriately. So big thing with pain, and I'm sure you cover this in other classes, but just to make sure we're all on the same page, it really is a truly subjective experience. And so can you look at a person and tell how much pain they're in? Especially if it's on the inside. I'm just kidding. No, you really can't. So, certainly if I have a displaced fracture, you can probably look at me and say, like, yeah, you're probably in some pain, right? But especially with some of these chronic patients, my wife, she did her second year residency in pain management at the VA. And so a lot of those VAs, you got these older vets who are tough as nails, and they don't really want to show a whole lot of pain, right? So even though you look at them, they maybe have significant lower back pain, whatever happens to be, but they may not look like it, right? Especially over time, as you kind of get used to it, you can see that, like, they don't show a lot of that. What are some other ways you can kind of look at and assess pain in a patient? Yeah, so heart rate, respiration, you know, so certain physiological signs, but again, you lose those over time, you know, especially as you get kind of more used to it, that may just be your new baseline, right? So very much it's what the patient's telling you, but what's the other concern with what patients tell you?
They lie.
They lie like rugs. A lot of them do. Some of them are actually legitimate, but this is where you run into problems where patients will go to certain providers and they say, well, I just don't write for opioids. I just won't give them, it doesn't matter if you have a broken leg, I'm not going to give you anything. You'll have certain pharmacies where the pharmacists say, I'm not going to fill any of these prescriptions, right? And so that can be significant barriers for some of your patients. We ran in particular issues where, you know, if you call a pharmacy and say, hey, do you have any, I have a prescription for OxyContin, do you have any in stock? What are they going to tell you? They're not going to tell you anything, right? Because they're going to say, we're out of it, we don't have any, because you don't want to get robbed. My second day working in a CVS, I was a young intern, and we had a dude walk right into the pharmacy. We were getting a shipment in, so the door happened to be open. Guy walked in with a knife and stole two bottles of Loratab, right? So this is a big concern. And so, you know, if you were to call a pharmacy and say, hey, do you have this? They're going to tell you we're out, right? Because they don't want to get robbed. So this is a big concern at Nemours, where we would prescribe patients things like, you know, Hyset, which is a hydrocodone acetaminophen liquid. And it would be after hours, so our pharmacy would be closed, the outpatient pharmacy. And so they'd call around and say, hey, do you have any of the Hyset liquid? My kid's in pain. They're going to say, no, we don't have anything, right? So that was a big concern of it. Just availability of the medication can be a big concern for patients as well. So keep in mind that you are really looking for the patient to give you the most reliable indicator of their pain, of their subjective nature of it, and how they describe it can be really important for determining what type of pain you're dealing with. So it's basically whatever the patient says it is, whether they're lying to you or not, that's what you have to work on. So we will talk about treating both acute and chronic pain, because the therapies for those are going to be very, very different. Obviously, chronic pain just being something that's persistent, lasting long periods of time versus, you know, could be kind of more intermittent, could be related to certain factors, you know, if they're moving or whatever it happens to be. Acute pain being more kind of a one-time kind of short-term issue. And the big thing to focus on here is going to be this kind of this etiology of the pain. So whether it's going to be more visceral, somatic, or neuropathic, that's going to be determining what type of drugs you're going to be using for those as well. So we'll kind of key in on what those are in just a little bit. So again, just kind of comparing the acute pain versus chronic pain. Keep in mind that, you know, usually with the acute pain issue, say they're post-op, say they just had a fracture, it's limited in nature. What do you think their risks are for getting a patient addicted to a medication like an opioid for acute pain is? Lower, yeah, than you would see with something with someone who has chronic pain, right? So if you're having to dose them for, you know, years and years and years, you're more likely to develop a lot of tolerance to these medications and potential addiction. I knew during my schooling, we had to had this like community outreach thing. We got assigned basically a patient. We were working as an interdisciplinary team. We're working with like nurses and nursing students and someone else. We had to go see this patient, and basically he had an issue where he was actually in an elevator accident years before, where he was actually dropped in an elevator a certain number of floors, ended up having like severe nerve pain in his back. And so just him being able to acquire the medications he needed, unless it was like a pharmacist he really knew, he couldn't get a lot of that because he was on such high doses. Because as we'll see with tolerance to these medications, you eventually have to start ramping up your dose with more chronic patients, that it can be very scary when you get those doses and you're like, oh, I don't know if I want to feel that, or I don't know if I want to write for that because the doses are so high. We see this a lot, especially with our sickle cell patients at Nemours, from the pediatric standpoint. A lot of those patients have chronic pain issues where they are on opioids for long periods of time. And so, say for instance, you know, say for a 20 kilogram child, you know, 2 milligrams of morphine is going to be enough to deal with most pain they have. For a kid who has sickle cell, you may need to use like 5 milligrams of morphine or even more because they are so tolerant to those doses. And so you typically see much higher doses used for chronic pain issues than someone who's, say, opioid naive. So when we're talking about nociceptive pain versus neuropathic pain, what's kind of the big differences between those, do you think? Right, so as you might imagine, neuropathic pain has to deal with the nerves, right? And the nociceptive pain is really going to be more that somatic or visceral pain. So again, rising from the organs or from the tissues versus dealing from the nerves specifically. And so we'll see how those are described a little differently. I'm sure you've covered this previously, but neuropathic pain is usually kind of shooting, burning, tingling, you have paresthesias, things like that. What are some common causes for neuropathic pain? Diabetes, so you have diabetic neuropathy. What else?
Sciatica.
Fibromyalgia.
Surgery.
Hmm?
surgery problems?
Potentially, maybe like kind of more late term. Usually it's going to be more of the nociceptive pain they're having like post-op. You know, usually you don't see a ton of like nerve damage necessarily. But certainly they like botch something up, you know, during the surgery, they could have nerve pain, you know, kind of down the road for sure. Yep. So those are good causes. Nociceptive pain, you know, everyone's had that. Sprain your ankle, you cut yourself, have a fracture, whatever. That's, you know, usually going to be described as more kind of dull, aching, sharp, you know, very, very different. So how your patient describes these is going to be important to determining what type of medications you want to use. So we know the cost is going to be huge, either in lost productivity, disability, or lost work days, and quality of life is going to take a big hit as well for a lot of these patients. So I won't beleaguer that point. So we'll talk a little bit about pain assessment. Have you guys covered anything about pain assessment before? How do you guys normally assess for pain?
On a scale of 1 to 10.
On a scale of 1 to 10, say. So on a 1, you are having no pain whatsoever, and a 10 being I'm chopping your arm off with a dull axe. I describe it to them like that, and they'll be like, I'm an 8. And I'm like, you're just sitting there. You look fine. I'm an 8 right now. Okay. Right, so again, kind of going back to the subjective nature of this. Interestingly enough, you know, when looking at things like number scales and whatnot, my wife found that a lot of those patients, they get tied to their numbers, right? So especially the chronic pain patients, they're like, I'm a 6, right? And 6 is just their normal. And so they are very, very tied to that 6. And even if you change all their stuff and they say, oh, how do you feel? Like, oh, I feel a ton better. What's your pain scale out of 1 to 10? I'm a 6. Like they're very kind of emotionally tied to that number, and so and we'll talk about goals for your patients, and even sometimes getting to a 1 is never going to be possible. Even getting from a 6 to say a 4.5 for that patient may be perfect for them. So we'll look at some of those assessments and how we can kind of compare and contrast and how we can use those to determine our goals for treatment. So again, you guys know about this. You're looking for a location of the pain, the onset and duration, kind of what helps it, what makes it worse. Talk about the characteristics, because this will kind of delineate whether it's going to be more of kind of a nociceptive pain versus a more neuropathic pain that we're dealing with. So I won't kind of get into too much detail on these. And we also talk about the intensity of the pain. So we talk about the verbal analog scale. So again, 0 to 10. You can ask them, is it, you know, mild, moderate, severe? Again, this is all going to be subjective based on the patient. What's kind of the benefits of using your numbers? Yeah, you can look at things over time, so you can see, you know, looking, okay, you were 10, you know, when you came in, I gave you a dose of morphine, come back, and now you're 4, right? So those are very useful to make those kind of comparisons. I find also that you'll see in a lot of, you know, because of the subjective nature of it, it's, you know, people can kind of goose the numbers a little bit. So if you're doing research, say, looking at different, you know, opioid treatments or something like that, they can say, oh, I'm certainly a 6, or I'm certainly, you know, a 5, whatever. But another way you can do that is also using a visual analog scale. So you can see here where you can basically say, okay, on the left side, you have no pain. On the right side, you have pain as bad as it could possibly be. That's a little easier for to get kind of more objective determinations by the patient, because they're not looking at a number specific, they're kind of pointing at a range, and so they're less likely to be able to point at the same spot every single time, right? So sometimes that can be useful, and you'll see that being done in studies more often than you would say being used at the bedside. And then obviously for patients who maybe cannot communicate very well or have kind of limited mental faculties, you may see being the faces being used, a very common one, or maybe like a thermometer for some of your geriatric patients, maybe something they're more familiar with. So again, you're gonna be looking at modifying factors. The big thing I wanna focus on is previous treatment. So it's good to ask, what have they been on previously? How did that work for them? Because that's gonna determine whether I'm gonna use the same thing again, or I might change gears completely. And then also looking at things like, you know, look at their function, their behavior, you know, maybe they can only get up and walk, you know, across the room one time because of their pain, but you give them, you know, you kind of tune up their therapy. Now they can walk, you know, across the room a couple of times or whatever. So different factors will kind of tell you just how functional they're going to be. Okay, so again, you also want to assess medication history. Certainly, this can be an issue if you're having patients who are self-medicating. Again, that can be either legal or illegal drugs. It's important to assess for those, because some of those could be actually impacting their pain. Physical assessments, their labs, history of substance abuse. So again, whether it be personal or family history, because again, some links there are genetic in nature, to say like some people are more prone to becoming addicted to medications than others, right? And then also you look at your psychosocial assessment to see what other kind of concomitant issues they have going on. A lot of times, you know, pain can be related to someone's depression. And maybe if you fix their depression, their pain gets a little bit better and makes it more easily manageable. So just keep that in mind. So when you are treating chronic pain, you're going to be seeing that for a lot of these patients, they're going to have some baseline level of pain that's always there, and you're going to have things that will exacerbate it. So the way we normally treat those patients is going to be with using both around-the-clock medication, and then we'll also use breakthrough medication, right? So if you imagine, you know, you have drugs that are either immediate release, you have some that are extended release. The extended release are going to be good for covering patients throughout the day, right? There's going to be long-acting medications, maybe every 12 hours or every 8 hours or something. That deals with that kind of low-line base level pain. And then for the breakthroughs, that's where you're going to have your more immediate release drugs, right? So it's important you don't get those mixed up, because if you could lead to some significant adverse effects if you kind of give you know, an extended release product every time they have breakthrough pain, next time you find them, you know, passed out on the floor, right? Don't want to do that. So as far as approaches to treatment, there is kind of a ladder-based approach that was put out by the World Health Organization that still kind of stands. And you'll also see that, you know, based on the etiology of the pain, can adjust how you're going to be treating that. So obviously someone who has palliative, you know, end-stage cancer pain versus someone who broke their arm might be treated a little bit differently. So traditionally you would see, you know, starting out with, say, I'm going to, you know, go step one, start out with non-opioid treatment. This would be things like non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, acetaminophen, and then you kind of jump up as you go along to more kind of bigger guns. Then you start to get into more opioids for mild to moderate pain, plus adjuvants, and then you maybe go even higher, maybe say IV opioids, right? Is it always appropriate to start at step one? So if I broke my arm, it's going this way. Should you start at step one? Say, here's some Tylenol. Probably not, right? So this is where it's important to really assess your patient and figure out where you should really be starting at. And again, maybe they're having appendicitis. Maybe you can't tell how much pain they're actually in because they don't have a displaced fracture, right? So again, this is all based on what the patient's really telling you, is how much pain they're really experiencing. So again, this ladder was really developed for cancer pain initially, but it can be generally generalizable to other types of pain as well. But just be aware that some patients with severe pain, you gotta start at the top of the ladder. Sometimes you're gonna need some IV therapy to help deal with that initial bout of acute pain, and then you kind of worry about the other adjuvants later. So, we'll talk about different modalities of therapy, and so the first thing we'll talk about is going to be just the steps of inflammation. We've covered a lot of this before because we're going to be talking about things like acetaminophen and the NSAIDs and how they're going to be affecting this. So initially, you're going to have your tissue insult, whatever happens to be, whether it's trauma, chemical irritant, foreign protein infection, whatever happens to be it's causing the tissue inflammation. We know that there's a lot of inflammatory cytokines that get involved here, so we're going to be seeing the arachidonic acid pathway being activated, prostaglandins being produced, leukotrienes. Histamine is going to be a big one here as well, basically releasing all these local mediators in order to start to attract other types of cells and whatnot in order to deal with this inflammation. Again, you're going to be seeing leukocytes starting to migrate to the area. We're going to see that dealing with things like prostaglandins, substance P, are going to be good ways in order to help kind of deal with pain at the local area, right? We're going to see that a lot of the pain fibers starting to get activated, especially when you have things like bradykinin, substance P activating them, that we're also going to be able to deal with pain as it travels through the nerves up to the CNS. And so that'll be the other kind of big place we're going to be dealing with the actual pain that the patient's experiencing. So as you might imagine, you can see here at the top, you have this tissue injury that's occurred. Notice you have a lot of the local mediators being liberated. That arachidonic acid is being liberated from the tissue membrane in order to start to produce things like your prostaglandins and whatnot. And that's all going to be kind of carried through these nerve fibers through the spinal cord up into the brain. So you're going to see that a lot of things like corticosteroids, a lot of things like non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs are going to be working here locally at the site of inflammation. Whereas things like our opioids are going to be working, where do you think they work? Things like morphine, oxycodone, where do they work? Yeah, so they're going to be working more on in the brain, in the CNS. They're going to be working in the spinal cord. That's where we're going to see a lot of those receptors actually lie for the opioids. They're not working locally to decrease inflammation. They're working on the actual perception of pain that's being transmitted through those nerve fibers. So one thing that we can do is give drugs with anti-inflammatory activity, so we can inhibit things like prostaglandins and leukotrienes. This helps to mediate that vasomotor activity. We can block some of the permeability changes, some of the edema and swelling that occurs. These will also help to inhibit leukocyte migration and also a lot of those lysozymes that are being released from the leukocytes. So this is where our initial anti-inflammatories are going to be working. So again, prostaglandins are also going to help sensitize the pain fiber. So if we can deal with those prostaglandins and prevent them from being produced in the first place, that's going to be useful to decrease a lot of that pain that they're experiencing. So how do we do this? One of the main ways is to inhibit cyclooxygenase. You guys remember your favorite enzyme, right? What are the two different, I guess, what are the big differences between, say, like COX-1 and COX-2, without looking at the slide? Inducible versus, what was the other word? Constitutive. I think that's a good $5 word. So what we're really going to be seeing is, by inhibiting cyclooxygenase, the big one you want to focus on is COX-2, right? Because that's going to be our inducible cyclooxygenase. This is responsible for causing a lot of the inflammation, affecting a lot of the other inflammatory cytokines that are being produced. So that's really the main one we're going to be seeing being activated during these acute pain issues. COX-1 being the constitutive enzyme, this is what's responsible for affecting the stomach, the kidneys, and all that good stuff. So there'll be some inherent problems with inhibiting COX-2 only, but ideally, in an ideal world, that's the enzyme you mainly want to focus on. We'll see that some drugs are going to be either irreversible or reversible. Do you guys remember what the irreversible one is? Aspirin is going to be the one that's an irreversible inhibitor. And you also see that some will be competitive versus non-competitive, which may have an effect on how quickly they actually start to work. So, looking at how you actually can go about these stepwise approach to treat these, normally if you're looking at somatic and visceral pain, that nociceptive pain, this is where dealing with the inflammation is going to be a major component, where you're using things like NSAIDs or acetaminophen or maybe even corticosteroids to deal with initial inflammation. And then opioids can be used as well. So kind of plus minus whether or not you need that. With neuropathic pain, we're going to see that the pathway is a little bit different. We're going to be using different types of drugs like antidepressants, anticonvulsants, even some muscle relaxers, things like baclofen, and then opioids as well can be used for some of that pain. So that's kind of the main differences you're going to see between how we treat those types of pain. We'll talk about those in detail as we go forward. Okay, so any questions from last week's material? Anything about the OB-GYN stuff? You guys have any questions? Oh, you
had? Yeah, you had mentioned that there's some hepatic effects to the estrogen. What kind of effects are we looking for?
Right, so a lot of the hepatic effects have to do with mainly the oral products. You're going to see more effects from that than you would from, say, like the transdermal or, say, like the vaginally applied ones. So you end up seeing things like the cholecystitis risk, right, because that's the main way that a lot of the estrogens are being metabolized and excreted, is through the bile tract, so you worry about that. You also worry about the clotting effects as well. So that's where we see a lot of the clotting factors being produced, and so those get upregulated when you have a higher number of estrogens going through the liver. Makes sense. I had a good question as well. Someone was asking about the irreversible aromatase inhibitors and like kind of how those effects get reversed. Does anyone know how that would occur? So if I'm in, you know, basically irreversibly inhibited enzyme, how does that function of the enzyme return? Yeah, precisely. You make new ones. So very similar to when we talked about aspirin and that being an irreversible inhibitor of cyclooxygenase within the platelets, the only way you get more platelet function back is by producing more platelets, right? So you end up basically during the lifetime of that aromatase enzyme, it's being inhibited, but as that gets degraded and you have new ones being produced, that's how you end up having return of function. So if you continue to take that medication over a long period of time, the enzyme level, the activity stays low because you're inhibiting new enzyme as it gets produced, right? But if I stop taking it, eventually that enzyme gets metabolized and then new enzyme gets made and then the function starts to return. That makes sense? Any other questions? Any ClinMed questions you guys maybe have about medications before Friday? Because I know that's your first test, right? Because I'm not covering that until next week, so I just want to see if there's anything I can answer maybe beforehand that might help clear anything up. Antidepressants or anything?
I just need to pull up the chart.
Okay. Or antipsychotics, or which ones happen to work for me better than others? Really delve deep into that one.
Still,
I got 2 hours, so.
Sorry, I'm in the wrong folder. I'm so sorry. It's really early.
That's true. So I talk about pain management because this is such a painful time to be doing farm lectures.
Can Zoloft cause serotonin syndrome just like all the other ones?
Yeah, so the risk is pretty low if you're using a single agent, right? So if I, even if you take really high doses of, say, an SSRI like Zoloft or Prozac or, you know, fluoxetine, any of those, they're very unlikely to cause serotonin syndrome by themselves. I even see patients who will take very significant overdoses of one of these drugs and they don't really run into any problem. Very frequently, it's when you start to mix medications that will have similar mechanisms of action to where you can see that being a problem. So, say, for instance, you had someone who had, say, like an MAO on board, like a monoamine oxidase inhibitor on board, plus an SSRI. Or one of the things that I saw a very interesting case report of, have you guys heard of the drug methylene blue? What do we use that for?
Bladder infections.
Potentially bladder infections.
Estrogen violence.
It's an old drug, but essentially you would use it sometimes either to treat methemoglobinemia, basically give blue patients a blue drug, it turns them pink again. That's kind of, I remember that one. But it also can be used to, it gets preferentially uptaken into the parathyroid, so it can stain them. So if you had to do a parathyroidectomy, you could actually see it, visualize it much better to see where the tissue is to remove it. So we actually ran into a case report where a patient who is on an SSRI, which is increasing levels of serotonin, right? Well, methylene blue also kind of does the same thing. It has some ability to inhibit monoamine oxidase. And so there was a patient who was undergoing parathyroidectomy, and they did not realize that the patient was on an SSRI, gave them the methylene blue, and so then all of a sudden they started to develop hyperthermia, they started to have the muscular rigidity and all of that, and so they determined it was serotonin syndrome. So those drug interactions are really where it gets you. You guys know any antibiotics that have big MAOI effects?
Linazolid
is another big one. So oftentimes they'd recommend you have a kind of a washout period of your SSRI before going on linazolid. Sometimes that's not always possible, but that's another risk you run into with some regularity.
Yes? So for Ritalin, why does it increase warfarin levels and why does it decrease antihypertension effects?
So why do you think Ritalin, which is what drug?
It's for ADHD.
It's for ADHD. What kind of drug is it? What's a generic name?
Methylphenidate.
Methylphenidate. Okay, so why do you think methylphenidate? What does that drug do? It's a stimulant, right? So it's an amphetamine. So it's increasing release of catecholamines. It's kind of odd. It's kind of counterintuitive. You think, how can I focus better if I am so ramped up, right? If I'm having all these kind of pro-sympathetic effects. But it works for ADHD. It helps you kind of just very narrowly focus in. And so if you're increasing release of catecholamines like norepinephrine and epinephrine, what do you think that does to your blood pressure and heart rate? Should increase it, right? So you're kind of counteracting the effects of your antihypertensives by directly affecting that. With warfarin, it says you would increase the effects of warfarin?
Yeah.
Clinically, I don't see that too frequently. It's very not common that I see a patient who's on warfarin and an amphetamine at the same time. I mean, usually just the age ranges aren't really matching up for that one, so to speak. It might have to do with maybe some platelet effects from the sympathetic flow, but yeah, clinically I don't run into that one super commonly, so I had to look that up to get more info.
Does it cause priapism because of the norepinephrine?
Yeah, it's going to be more from those type of effects. You don't see that super frequently. One drug you will see that with, an antidepressant, do you guys know? Sometimes used for sleep.
Ambien.
Not Ambien. That's more like a benzodiazepine. This one's an antidepressant specifically. Trazodone is a big one. So trazodone actually is an alpha blocker, or has some alpha blocking effects, and so that one you can see priapism with. I had, you know, some cases of overdose where that was one of the presenting problems, was basically the priapism they had to deal with. So they had to get urology involved and all that. So that's a somewhat common one.
As soon as we see blurred vision with any of these antidepressants, do we take them off?
Not necessarily. I don't run into a ton of issues with blurred vision necessarily. It may be an issue of dose, or it could be where you switched over to another agent, it might improve. But certainly, you know, any changes in vision, you probably want to have someone evaluate that. You know, maybe something else is going on. Certainly, if you have like a drug with some anti-muscarinic effects, like a TCA, like you know, amitriptyline or something, we know based on those anti-muscarinic effects in the eyes that can cause issues with accommodation, and so that could just be related to the mechanism of the drug. It could be something else going on. So switching over to say like an SSRI could ameliorate some of those effects.
Do we have issues with patients who are on SSRIs or MAOs taking street drugs like ecstasy? Are they going to get into serotonin sickness or syndrome?
You certainly could run into that. That can be a problem. So something like ecstasy or methylene dioxymethamphetamine or MDMA, that one specifically has high serotonergic effects. That's why it's really that touchy-feely kind of like I want to hug everyone kind of drug versus something like methamphetamine where you're just like, I want to like punch everyone, right? So that one has a little bit different flavor because of the serotonergic effects. And absolutely, you can't see serotonin syndrome if you were to mix it, especially with an MAOA and you know, with a lesser risk with an SSRI or something like that. But yeah, that's definitely a possibility.
And for Adderall, is that like a basic drug or acidic drug? Because it says that antacids increase the excretion of it.
Yeah, so that's actually kind of an interesting one where people would try to alkalinize the blood in order to help reabsorb it. So right, remember, based on absorption of drugs to the GI tract, we said things with charges are less likely to be absorbed through that biologic membrane, right? Because they're less polar at that point. Or I'm sorry, they're more polar, they're less lipophilic. Same thing happens for reabsorption within the kidneys. So if something has a charge within the urine, it's gonna be more difficult for it to reabsorb it and to extend the half-life of it. So what some people would actually try to do would be to alkalinize the blood, say something like sodium bicarbonate, and that would actually lead the, remember light dissolves light, so the amphetamines are more basic drugs, so that would lead them to be less charged and they would be reabsorbed more easily in the kidneys, thus extending the half-life of them. Any other questions? All right, cool. If you have anything for Thursday, we can talk about it then as you get closer to the test. But so we will continue on with pain management. We'll talk about some of those medications, especially when we talk about neuropathic pain. So things like SSRIs and whatnot will come back up a little bit later in this lecture. So so some pearls when dealing with therapeutic management of pain. It's really important that we always try to utilize non-pharmacologic therapy and pharmacologic therapy when dealing with pain. So what are some non-pharmacologic therapy you could think of for dealing with pain? Ice is a good one. So biofeedback can be useful. Anything else? Heat, yeah, heat can be good too. So kind of alternating heat and ice. Massage, yeah, massage therapy. There could be even, you know, some more complementary medicine like, you know, acupuncture and things like that could all be potentially useful. So lots of different things you want to use because, again, jumping straight to let's give you some opioids is not always going to be the best answer for your patients, right? Because we know there's going to be some drawbacks there. It's important to incorporate kind of a multimodal approach. So look at the not only the physical aspects of it, but also the psychological and behavioral issues. Sometimes, you know, patients who have prior history of substance abuse are going to be more likely to abuse something like an opioid versus someone who doesn't have any of those kind of prior problems. And then as far as our treatment goals, we want to either prevent, reduce, or eliminate pain. Is it always possible to completely eliminate pain? No, especially for some of these chronic guys or ladies, they are going to have pain issues that are going to last the rest of their lives. The best thing you can do is try to help ameliorate some of that and try to help make it a little bit more bearable for them. So like I said, talking about treatment goals for patients, you know, sometimes, you know, if their pain's an 8 out of 10, sometimes getting down to a 7 is going to be perfect for them, right? Because they've never been down to a 7 in years. So trying to get those goals and trying to assess, you know, what's effective for them, what is what's bearable for them is going to be important there. And if we can improve their quality of life, their functional capacity, or their ability to retain independence, or if they can potentially regain it, would be beneficial as well. So we will determine the type of treatment they're going to do based on the type, severity, and the patient history. So you'll see that, you know, treating something like a fractured forearm acutely is going to be much different than treating, say, long-standing lower back pain. We'll see how those modalities will change based on, you know, the patient history and severity and type of pain. We will look and see that different patients will respond differently to various medications. So looking at things like opioid receptor variability, so some patients may express different types or numbers of receptors than other patients. And so they'll have variability to where some people will do really, really well on something like hydrocodone. Other people will just get super sick and nauseous from it and never want to take it again, right? So you'll see lots of variability there. And then it's very frequent you see multiple agents being used in tandem. So you may use something like an anti-inflammatory plus an opioid, or using something like a tricyclic antidepressant for neuropathic pain plus, say, an NSAID. So we'll look to see that you can use multiple drugs at the same time. And then if one therapy is unsuccessful or you have kind of intolerable side effects, definitely try other approaches. We'll talk about several different approaches here as we go forward. Okay, so the first pharmacologic options we'll look at is going to be acetaminophen. Then we'll look at some of our NSAIDs, opioids, and then our adjuvant agents. That'll be kind of the main pathway we'll go. We'll probably spend the most of the time on talking about the opioids, and that's probably the newest class of agents we'll talk about. So acetaminophen, I probably mentioned it before, but do you guys know where the name Tylenol comes from? It's bolded in the chemical name. So you can see the T-Y-L and E-N-O-L, that's where the name Tylenol comes from. You can also see where the APAP comes from, so the A-P-A-P, you can see on there. So if you're ever curious, that's where it comes from. Acetaminophen is going to be nice because it has good analgesic and antipyretic properties, and it's very widely used for mild to moderate pain. One of the things I will probably harp on is that when you're prescribing medications for pain, how do you frequently prescribe them? How often should they take them? As needed, absolutely. So what should you put after the as needed? Yeah, the specific indication for when they should be taking it, right? So it's really, really important, and this is something that the Joint Commission, especially if you work in the hospital, is going to harp on, is having specific indications for medication. So, for instance, if I had a patient who had, say, acetaminophen tablets, they can take every 4 hours as needed for pain, and then I have, say, oxycodone, they can take every 6 hours as needed for pain, and the nurse is trying to figure out which one to give, how should she decide which one to give? You want to get the Tylenol first? Okay. How's the nurse going to know that? Well, she wouldn't, right? So then you're expecting her to make an independent decision, which is not within their scope of practice, right? So that's become a big issue to where, they don't want nurses doing independent prescribing. And so you have to have very specific orders. So you would say, for instance, you could say acetaminophen every 4 hours is needed for pain, say a pain scale of 1 through 3. And then you could do, say, oxycodone for a scale of 4 through 10. Okay, or you could say give acetaminophen as needed for pain, and then you would give the oxycodone if pain unrelieved by acetaminophen, right? So put very very specific instructions on there, so that way the nurse has no leeway there. She knows exactly what to give and when to give it based on the way the orders are written. And so I know that we went through that. We had a Joint Commission survey probably just a year ago at Nemours, and so that was a huge thing, is going through and building out a lot of order sets. So a lot of that was already done for the providers, because guess how many people remember to do that? Not very many. And then we'd have to call you up from the pharmacy and say, hey, can we just put this, all these PRN indicators on here? And they say, yeah, of course, do whatever. So really need to have good, clear expectations for that. So getting back to acetaminophen, this is going to be, pretty common medication that most people end up getting put on at some point in their lives. First line therapy, especially for things like osteoarthritis, lower back pain, and for the most part, is going to be generally well tolerated. We actually have a newer form that's available. So there's an IV formulation now called Ofirmiv. And this is actually nice because we can see that if you give this in the post-operative setting, it can actually limit the amount of opioids that a patient actually needs in total. So if you actually look at studies where patients either got a dose of IV acetaminophen versus where they didn't, they actually end up using less opioids than the patients that received the IV acetaminophen. Okay. More expensive than a tablet. So say, for instance, like a bottle of Ofirmiv, a 1 gram bottle is, say, $35 versus, say, 2 cents for a tablet or something. So the cost difference is certainly there. But again, if you can think about it, and we'll talk about the side effects of opioids, but if you can limit the amount of opioids a person needs in the postoperative setting, you may be able to speed the time back to their baseline and be able to get their discharge a little bit faster and not have to use as many drugs on them. So that can all be a positive thing. So we'll look at other drugs that are also opioid sparing. This is good to remember that anything we can do to limit the amount of opioids people need to get is going to be a good thing.
When you say postoperative, like, the day after or for like weeks following?
Yeah, so what we would do just in our clinical setting is we actually just give them one dose post-surgery, and that will usually kind of get them started, and then you can give either PO or PR dosage forms after that. But kind of giving them kind of a boost with the IV dose right off the bat seems to be the most useful. We will also use it for patients who cannot tolerate PO or PR Tylenol on other routes. So say, for instance, you have a patient who's on the hemonc unit and they are neutropenic. You never want to give anything rectally, right, because you worry about perforation of the rectum when you do that when they're neutropenic. You also can't give anything orally because they have really bad mucositis from the chemo that they're receiving. So in that case, IV acetaminophen actually is a really good option for them because they could be febrile neutropenia, so you want to deal with that fever in the first place and they feel really crummy, so that's it's a good option for them as well.
Are you going to avoid the first pass effect by going IV?
Yeah, so you also bypass first pass, so you don't have as kind of a big of a liver tax on that. And when it comes through, you get that kind of, if you give a full gram of that, you're more likely to get a higher percentage of that actually, kind of getting all over the body versus working, some of it getting degraded in the liver. It's a very good point as well. But the suppositories would do the same thing, right? So anytime you're giving something rectally, you're going to be bypassing the first pass effect as well. So keep that in mind. So, acetaminophen, it is generally going to be seen to be working more potent centrally. You will see that it does not work super well in inflamed tissue. So you don't really get as much of an anti-inflammatory effect at local sites of injury as you would see with something like a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. So these are going to be better working for kind of centrally mediated pain. So where we see it for things like, low back pain, where there's not really like a true site of, it's not like a fresh injury there to really treat. And we don't really know the full mechanism. Some people postulated it works on cyclooxygenase 3 in the CNS, but just realize it's working more centrally than it is peripherally. So it also bypasses a lot of the anticoagulant effects that you end up seeing with COX inhibition by the NSAIDs, which is also good. And you have very few effects on, say, the cardiovascular system, GI, or respiratory effects. So all good things for our patients for dealing with pain. So the big thing to note, though, the big organ toxicity you worry about is going to be?
The
liver, absolutely. And so this is where you really limit how much patients should be receiving. So again, no more than, say, 4 grams in a day for patients. That would be for an otherwise healthy patient, right? And even then, if you give 4 grams every single day to a patient, even if it's spread out through a 24-hour period, you can still see elevations in their LFTs, right? So you can still see some potential injury there if they're taking this chronically every single day. Certainly patients who have hepatic impairment already, especially if they have cirrhosis of the liver from alcoholism or whatever it happens to be, they probably need to have that limited as well to something like 3,200 milligrams instead of 4 grams. And you have to consider all sources of acetaminophen. So for instance, if you're looking at a patient who's getting, say, acetaminophen 650 milligrams every 6 hours, so how many times a day are they getting that?
Four times
a day, right? And then they're also getting, say, hydrocodone acetaminophen, Lortab or Norco, that would be the brand name for that, 5-3-25. That's how you'll frequently see that being listed. The first number is going to be the hydrocodone component. The second is the acetaminophen. They're taking that every 4 hours. If you calculate that out, it's going to be well over 4 grams, right? So consider that. Consider how much your patient's actually going to be getting. Very frequently, especially on the outpatient side, if you tell them, hey, I'll give you a prescription for Lortab, don't take any other acetaminophen, right? Because you can't really modulate how much they're actually going to be taking and self-medicating on the outside. On the inpatient side, they're using things like electronic medical record systems are nice because they will actually give you a warning. They'll actually calculate the total amount of acetaminophen they've gotten within a day and will give you a warning to say, hey, they've already received their 4 grams, and actually prevent the nurse from giving the medication, assuming they do all the scanning and documenting before they actually give the medication. But so always consider all sources of acetaminophen.
So what do you do for the patient in that situation? Patients in pain and
you could switch over to using like a non-acetaminophen based product. So for instance, if you were giving them Percocet, which is oxycodone acetaminophen, you can give them Roxycet, which is just oxycodone by itself. Yeah, so very frequently if you're prescribing, say, acetaminophen, say, around the clock as needed for pain, oftentimes it's better off just to give a plain opioid by itself instead of giving them combination. Okay, so then moving on, you have your NSAIDs, which are going to have good analgesic, antipyretic, and anti-inflammatory actions. We will see these very commonly being used, almost as commonly as acetaminophen, because of its availability as an over-the-counter preparation. Which ones are available over-the-counter? Ibuprofen, aspirin, and? Yeah, naproxen is going to be the other one, right? So those are kind of the three main ones you're going to see being available in an over-the-counter fashion. So we know, we talked about these before, but they inhibit cyclooxygenase 1 and 2 that will help to decrease prostaglandin synthesis, right? And this is very much upregulated when you have areas of inflammation. So looking here at this slide, we've probably seen something very similar before. But again, remember that when you're having an inflammatory insult that's occurring, the membrane phospholipids are being acted on by this phospholipase A2. That's liberating arachidonic acid. And from here, this is where we can start to produce a lot of our inflammatory mediators by working through the cyclooxygenase pathway. And remember, COX-1 is going to be, is this the one that's inducible or is it more constitutive? Yeah, COX-1 is constitutive, right? You're always expressing that one versus COX-2 being inducible, right? So that's the one we really want to focus on for its anti-inflammatory properties. And remember when we talked about things like NSAID-induced asthma, this is the same pathway that's happening here. So again, when you are limiting the activity of cyclooxygenase, that arachidonic acid is still being produced. It has to go somewhere. So if it can't go through this pathway here, it's going to end up going through this lipoxygenase pathway. And so by producing more leukotrienes, that can potentially induce an asthma attack in susceptible patients. So keep that in mind as well when we mention that side effect. So we will mention a couple of different NSAIDs here, especially ones we may not have seen before. We'll talk about some kind of unique properties to them. There's no clear advantage for one class over another. Some people may respond to one class versus another. So say some people will respond to aspirin better than they will, say, naproxen. And so you really just need to find what works for your patient specifically. There's also going to be a variety of dosage forms. So there are going to be some that are available IV. Some you can give IM, rectal suppository. So just because they can't take something orally doesn't mean they can't take an NSAID at all. And then again, if you are looking at individual responses to treatment, you know, try 2 or 3 week trials to see how they're really going to do with it, right? Let them know that, hey, this may not have full effect right off the bat. Give it time to see how it kind of works for you. So we know the common side effects are going to be related to its mechanism of action. So the big one being gastric or intestinal ulceration. This is really related to a decrease in that mucus that's being released into the stomach to form that protective barrier. So you limit that mucus production, you're going to be kind of leaving that acid to work on the stomach lining to potentially cause ulcerations, perforations potentially. We also see decreased platelet aggregation leading to bleeding risk. Now, which one is going to have the most bleeding risk, do you think? Yeah, so her aspirin, right? Why aspirin?
Irreversible.
Yeah, so like we said, it's an irreversible inhibitor on platelets, so that's going to provide the most long-lasting kind of anti-platelet effect.
Isn't true that naproxen's the one that gives you more of like the risk of having the ulcers, the GI ulcers and stuff like that?
I didn't see anything specifically. That one is really meant to be taken less frequently because it has a little longer duration of action. So I could see if you're taking that more frequently throughout the day like you would something like an ibuprofen, you could run into that problem, but I haven't seen anything specifically for that. Not to say that that literature doesn't exist, I just haven't run across it. You also worry about some hypersensitivity reactions rarely in some patients. And then we also kind of talked about how these can cause some problems. So it being, you know, kind of a category D drug in the third trimester, but this can delay spontaneous labor. We also remember those adverse fetal effects. So, you know, if it closes that patent ductus arteriosus too early, that can lead to circulation issues for an unborn fetus. Although we can use it for the exact therapeutic purpose of closing that ductus arteriosus after they're born if they don't close, if they don't have it closed naturally. Yes?
Does that include aspirin?
So that's going to include, yeah, anything that's inhibiting cyclooxygenase like that, it can do it, right?
Yesterday we were told that you're supposed to give a baby aspirin for people who are preeclamptic.
Mm-hmm.
Will that put a risk of closing their baby?
That's probably such a low dose that you're not really going to see as big of an issue, right? This is more like if you're taking like 800 of ibuprofen or something, like, you know, big kind of full therapeutic doses versus just 81 milligrams. That's one of the things you really have to kind of balance out, the pluses versus minuses, right? And this is really only in the third trimester where you're really going to see the most effect on that, right? First and second trimester, they're still category B, I believe. So just keep that in mind. Does anyone know what drug you can give to keep the ductus arteriosus open for those patients?
Mm-hmm.
Actually, we give a prostaglandin. So as we mentioned that the NSAIDs are going to inhibit prostaglandin production, we can actually give a prostaglandin called alprostadil, and that actually can keep that ductus arteriosus open. So say, for instance, you have a kid born with a congenital anomaly of the heart. So we get this very frequently at Nemours, where, you know, we're not a birthing center, but we will certainly get kids who are born at outlying hospitals and transfer them in. Sometimes we have to get them started on an alprostadil drip in order to help keep that ductus arteriosus open, because their circulation is poor enough to where they still need that kind of mixing between the left and right side of the heart in order to make sure they're oxygenating everything appropriately. So sometimes you have to give them that until you can get to a point where you can fix what other congenital issues they have going on is. Okay, so we mentioned the asthma and the bronchospasm being a potential risk. So that's due to that increased lipoxygenase pathway that we saw there. And then you can maybe see some impaired hepatic function for some patients. Probably more of those that already have kind of pre-existing hepatic problems, but nothing like you would see with acetaminophen. Like acetaminophen really, if taken incorrectly, can really, you know, put someone into full hepatic failure. Here you're not really gonna see as big of an issue. And then, we do know about the kidney effects, where if you inhibit those prostaglandins, those are really important for keeping that that afferent arteriole open on the glomerulus. So if you close that down, it causes constriction and decreased renal blood flow. So you can kind of see an acute decrease in someone's GFR, especially if they're dependent on those prostaglandins to keep that arteriole open, right? We'll talk more about that when we get to talking about kidney injury and whatnot, when we talk about the renal stuff. So we mentioned salicylates probably being kind of the prototypical NSAID that's out there. Does anyone know where aspirin originally came from? The willow tree, absolutely. So you're taking the bark of the willow tree, you know, showing how plants give us a lot of our early medications. This one we know is going to be an irreversible, non-competitive antagonist. So this is going to be a constant effect on the platelets for the life of the platelet while it's there. And then we know it's non-selective for COX-1 and 2. So we'll talk about some drugs which will be somewhat selective for the different isoenzymes of cyclooxygenase. Now, when do you not want to use salicylates? Okay, so they have a bleeding risk, so that would be a good one. Potential stroke, right? What else? What age of patient would you not want to use it in? Yeah, so children, specifically what case in children do you not want to use it? Yeah, they're like have a viral illness or post-viral, you do not want to use salicylates for these kids, because what do you run the risk of? Yeah, Ray syndrome, right? So it's not a blanket that NSAIDs or aspirin is going to be contraindicated for kids, because sometimes we'll give it in the case of, does anyone know? Kawasaki is probably the big one. Sometimes in rheumatoid arthritis, you may see it being used, but Kawasaki's is probably the main one that I see kids being prescribed in. Yeah, rheumatic fever as well, yes. So if you have like kind of a post-strep rheumatic fever, you can see it used there as well. So again, when looking at salicylates and how they're acting, it's really on a spectrum. So kind of early on in the dosing, and this is important to look at the doses where you see these different effects. You know, something like 81 milligrams a day is going to be pretty good for causing the irreversible platelet effects. Even taking that every single day, even though it's low dose, not really good enough for, say, analgesic activity, can still provide that constant bleeding risk. As you start to increase the dose, where you start to see more potential bleeding risk, GI effects, and then you also start to see this tinnitus that can develop. And so that's when you start to get, you know, say 3 to 6 grams, you know, per day. Some people even get that when they are just taking a therapeutic dose. So for instance, back in the day when my boss at the poison center, they were doing some research looking at enhanced elimination of aspirin from the body. They would all take therapeutic doses, and even a gram would cause her to have really bad tinnitus, right? So be aware that can happen really at any dose. Some people just never get it. And then as you start to get higher and higher doses, aspirin has this ability to kind of uncouple oxidative phosphorylation and make your body go into a more anaerobic state. And so you can see really significant metabolic acidosis and cardiovascular failure. So really, really limit how much aspirin someone is taking. And be aware that there are different dosage forms that you may not really be familiar with. So has anyone heard of like Goody's powders or BC powders? A lot of people who are like from the north have like never heard of that stuff. But like down here, like a lot of the older patients use a ton of it. Anytime they have a headache or if they get chest pain or whatever reason, they take one of these powders. And so you may not understand that they've taken a significant dose of aspirin already and you're wanting to give them more of it potentially. So just be aware of that and make sure you're accounting for all sources of aspirin they may be getting. So obviously contraindications, we mentioned the bleeding disorders. We talked about the pregnancy, low doses being of benefit for hypertensive disorders, as we mentioned there. And then kids who are post-viral, do not give them for a risk of Ray syndrome. We know Ray syndrome is this fatty liver encephalopathy, have very high mortality if it's not caught early. So just be aware of that. Make sure you're avoiding it in that patient population. Okay, I'm not really going to talk about the different stages, but just be aware that it's very, very difficult to treat. We don't have any good options for them in a lot of cases. Best thing you can do, especially when they develop this fulminant, you know, encephalopathy, is try to pull off as much fluid from the CNS as possible. So that's where we use things like mannitol, which are hyperosmotic. And so when you give it in the bloodstream, it can help pull fluid across that blood-brain barrier and help to limit the, some of the swelling that you can see there. So again, try to catch it early if you can, or just not prescribe it at all is the best option. Okay, a couple other options within the salicylate categories. You have this difluminosal you might see every once in a while, sometimes used for osteo or rheumatoid arthritis. This one you're going to see very similar effects to aspirin, but you can also see some risk for rash and Stevens-Johnson syndrome. Have we talked about Stevens-Johnson before? Or what is that? Yeah, so it's this very severe skin reaction where it's an autoimmune kind of condition where you basically start to slough off basically all the skin, essentially potentially fatal if not caught early enough, and treated with, you know, kind of aggressive supportive care. So just be aware of that, and you know, if they start to have rash, you know, it should be an immediate discontinuation. So then we'll, so that's kind of the salicylate groups we'll talk about, and then we'll move on to the propionic acid derivatives. It's not really important to recognize the different classes that these NSAIDs fall into, but we'll talk about some specific features of different ones, and we'll, in, you know, kind of see the kind of pluses and minuses between them. But kinetically, they're all going to experience the same kind of pathway. They're all going to be absorbed very well orally. They're going to have hepatic conjugation and then renal elimination. No real renal dosing for a lot of these, so you don't have to worry about that, but certainly they have significant hepatic dysfunction. You may need to lower their doses for them. And for the most part, you're going to see less severe GI effects, but certainly that can all be related to the chronicity of use, the dose that you're using. You know, increasing either of those can increase your GI risk as well. And then frequently used for things like arthritis, muscle pain, dysmenorrhea, you can use these for any kind of pain condition. So the drugs that we'll see here, some familiar ones you've seen before, things like ibuprofen, naproxen. Notice the differences in the half-lives. Don't memorize these, but just be aware that, you know, based on the half-lives, they're going to be dosed a little bit differently. So that's why you always see the tagline for Aleve, you know, all day long, all day strong, whatever, because it has a longer half-life. So you only have to take it, say, once a day to get, you know, kind of all-day coverage versus something like ibuprofen, pretty short half-life. You need to take it, say, up to four times a day in order to achieve kind of around-the-clock coverage. So for patients of kind of chronic pain issues, something like, you know, an oxaprozin or Daypro is going to be good for them because it has a really long duration of action, can provide nice around-the-clock coverage, versus something like ibuprofen might be better for just acute pain issues or, say, breakthrough pain. You know, say you have a sprained ankle or something like that. You know, an acute pain issue, much better treated with short-acting medications.
With Daypro, with such a long half-life, is there a pretty decent risk for toxicity if somebody is taking it like every day?
That would be the case where, you know, if they are more prone to having any of the GI side effects, they might be on some other kind of protective medication. So, you know, may put them on something like a proton pump inhibitor or an H2 receptor antagonist to kind of help prevent some of that. I don't see that drug used super frequently. But yeah, so the more potent it is for you know, having those effects, and the more chronic the effects are, yes, you do increase your risk for those GI side effects. But again, some people are going to be more prone to that than others, right? You also have to consider, like, what's their diet like? You know, what's their stress levels like? And all kinds of other factors that go into increasing risk for GI ulcers.
But would they be taking this every day, or would they be taking it every...
No, they'd be taking it, like, every day. Because, again, you're getting to a steady state level at some point. It might just take longer with something like that. Yep. We'll talk about some drugs that have like a half-life of like 10 years, and we give them like, you know, once a year or something like that. So we'll talk about some very long half-life drugs eventually. So some of the NSAIDs we may or may not have talked about, we'll talk about some key points with them. So indomethacin being one that is previously used, it was available IV as well as orally, and this used to be kind of the go-to drug for closing the patent, the ductus arteriosus. So you see this given for neonates very frequently to close that up.
Sorry, just previously,
sure.
For the drug names, when you said we don't have to memorize, did you mean like the drug names or the peak in plasma? Or do you want us to know like the drug names?
You don't need to know the peak in plasma or the half-life necessarily, but yeah, certainly be able to recognize the drugs.
Sure.
Yep.
Thank you.
100%. So indomethacin does not get used very frequently just due to a lot of the side effects, including some hematologic toxicity and also things like ulcers and whatnot. Keep in mind that all of these NSAIDs are going to decrease the efficacy of diuretics. And why do you think that is?
Effect on the afferent arterial?
Yep, absolutely. Because you're closing the afferent arterial, that's decreasing renal blood flow. And so diuretics are really working with blood flow. So if it's not getting through the glomerulus, it has nothing to really diurese, so to speak. So it does limit the effects of different diuretics. So just be aware of that drug interaction that's available for all these NSAIDs. Indomethacin, also some of these you'll see are really recommended for short-term use only because of their side effects. So this is one of them. We'll talk about another one in just a little bit that, again, should be only used for, say, something like 5 days because of the side effects. Which would be this one, ketorolac or ketorolac. I think the actual pronunciation is ketorolac, but people look at you funny if you say that, so just say ketorolac or toradol. It's a lot easier. This one is a very good kind of go-to parenteral NSAID. So this is a very good IV NSAID to go to. We use it like water in the emergency department. They use it very frequently post-operatively because it has very similar analgesic activity to an opioid, with no actual opioid actions. So if you were coming with a fracture, chances are you're going to get a dose of Toradol. If you come in and you have abdominal surgery done, chances are you're going to get a dose of Toradol after that, because it has good opioid sparing effects, right? So instead of giving you a dose of an opioid, you can give Toradol instead, and it helps to limit a lot of that pain. Now, it does have a black box warning for GI effects. So this is why you limited the use to 5 days only. So very frequently you see this used mainly in the inpatient setting where you can limit how much you're actually going to be getting. So in a lot of places, especially with electronic medical records systems, they will actually hard stop you to only having 5 days worth. After that way, the orders will fall off the chart automatically, or it'll give you a warning saying, hey, patients already received 4 days of this, they can only receive 1 day more. So just be aware that GI toxicity is associated with this one. But otherwise, it's a very, very good drug for dealing with acute pain. I also have tolmetin or telectin. Again, very similar effects to a lot of the other drugs. Again, pretty significant incidence of side effects. So I don't see this one being used very frequently, but it's another one that's out there. Piroxicam, this one is going to be pretty equipotent to things like aspirin and naproxen. This one is nice because it actually has fewer side effects from the GI standpoint, and they're more mild in general. So sometimes you'll see this one being used for more kind of long-term NSAID use than you might see with some of the other agents, things like Toradol or things like the Tolmedin. Then we have meloxicam. So this one is good because it actually has some selectivity for the COX-2 enzyme versus having non-selectivity. So what are some of the benefits do you think of targeting the cyclooxygenase 2 versus being non-selective? Right, so you're targeting the one that has effects on inflammation, and so that means we're going to be sparing what organ? Yeah, the stomach mainly. You might still see some kidney effects a little bit, but for the most part, you're going to be limiting the GI effects. That's the main thing, because NSAID-induced ulcers can be a major problem. So if you can limit that, that's going to be beneficial. Does anyone have any problems with targeting the COX-2 enzyme specifically? Yeah, cardiovascular death specifically, right? Yes, we'll talk about that in just a few minutes. But this one, as long as you retain some activity against COX-1 and not exclusively targeting COX-2, you're okay, right? So this might have some benefits to be better for patients who have pre-existing GI conditions to where you don't want to aggravate that. So this might be a good drug for them. Another one, nebumetone. This one is actually a prodrug with an active metabolite, so this one has to get metabolized within the liver to become active. We'll have some COX-2 selectivity, but not exclusive COX-2 activity, as we'll see with some of these other drugs. Mainly used for things like rheumatoid and osteoarthritis for more chronic management of some of those patients. Diclofenac is another interesting one due to the available dosage forms for this one. This one is, again, going to have a little bit of COX-2 selectivity, has some limited side effects here. You're not going to really see it as significant as you might for some of the other NSAIDs, but one of the benefits here is that it's available as a topical dosage form. So this can be good for either chronic pain or it could be for some acute pain issues, but it's called Voltaren Gel. is what you'll see. So it's a prescription product here, but if you ever go on a cruise and go to Nassau, I can actually pick some up right from the pharmacies there. So a little pro tip.
How come, like in some countries, like I know in Germany we have that close back, but it comes in like a cream, mm-hmm. like local application. How come they are not allowed to have that here? They just have to sell.
So the way that the FD&C Act, the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act in the U.S. works is there's different components to it. But one of the things says that if there's a commercially available product, you cannot produce your own, you cannot like manufacture your own version of it, right? So for instance, you know, because Voltaren Gel is a commercially available product, I can't go ahead and just start to mass produce my own Voltaren Cream and start to sell that because of the fact that I don't have as good of you know, regulations on my manufacturing practices and things like that. So it's really meant to protect the consumer so that if you're getting Voltaren Gel, you know it's a well-made product, safe, it's efficacious for what its intended use is. So you know there are compounding pharmacies for sure, but usually you're making things on a individual patient basis. You're not like kind of mass producing things for selling. So that's more related to U.S. law than it is anything else.
Is it more like political, I guess? Because it's safe to use.
I mean, it all comes back to money in the end, probably. So, but also, you know, it's one of those things where, like, do I want to go pick up, you know, Jim Bob's diclofenac cream? Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. Right. But but they're trying to, you know, kind of stymie operations like that, right? Where you're getting kind of dubious things of dubious quality, I guess. Yep.
Isn't this one really expensive?
I'm not sure of the price off the top of my head. It's probably more expensive than ibuprofen would be, but because it is this kind of a specialized dosage form, it might be a little more expensive.
Is this Pennsaid? Is
this the same thing as Pennsaid? I don't know off the top of my head. Not familiar with that brand name specifically. I know Voltaren's is the most common one, probably. Okay, anyway, so yeah, so this is going to be good for a kind of local application, especially if you're only having localized pain instead of, you know, say, kind of more systemic, you know, kind of all over pain. Okay, so then going specifically to the COX-2 inhibitors, we really only have one drug that's available that's used very frequently that has kind of the most selectivity for COX-2, which we'll talk about. But it has very similar efficacy to other NSAIDs, but very, very low incidence of GI side effects. And so the big concern here is going to be with the cardiovascular safety. Essentially, what you end up seeing is that when you inhibit COX-2 only, you had some problems with things like angiogenesis and production of new blood vessels and things like that. So it actually led to increases in heart attack, stroke, things like that. And so because of that, things like rofecoxib or Vioxx was actually taken off of the market. So these are things that, even though they went through the normal, you know, three phases of clinical testing and they seem safe, when you start giving it to millions of patients, then it became a problem. That's when you started to notice those things that have a very low incidence start to pop up. So it's got removed from the market. And now the one drug that we have that's really COX-2 selective is going to be celecoxib or Celebrex. And there appears to be pretty neutral effects on cardiovascular risk because it does still have some COX-1 activity as well. So. Again, these are all going to be reversible agents, but really the main one we're going to be looking at is going to be celecoxib or Celebrex. The only other one that's really available is going to be etodolac. Sometimes I'll actually see this being used in vet offices. So if your dog needs an NSAID, sometimes etodolac will be used. I don't know if I've seen a human actually use it before, but theoretically it would work just as fine. So as far as looking at the actual inhibition of COX-2, you can see the ones that had the most effect were the ones that were associated with more cardiovascular risk. So those are ones that got pulled off the market. Celebrex, again, having some activity for COX-1 is pretty neutral on cardiovascular effects, so is still available here in the U.S. So again, you can kind of look to see why that cardiovascular risk came about. So again, when they're inhibiting things like prostacyclin, more so than thromboxanes, that's where you also saw some issues with the epithelial cells and the blood vessels. And so we had increased risk for myocardial infarction, strokes, increased blood pressure, all kinds of bad things. And so that's why this got pulled. Okay, so I'll give you a 10-minute break now, and we'll come back and discuss our opioids. So any questions on the NSAIDs or anything else like that? So someone had a good question. They were talking about Toradol or Ketorolac. So again, that's a good IV NSAID that we use a lot for acute pain issues. And so someone asked, oh, well, you know, is that the one that you can give IM? And yes, you can give intramuscular injections of Toradol. It's very frequently used when you don't have IV access on a patient or you don't plan to get IV access. It can be a good option there. And so they asked, oh, does it work better at the site where you inject it versus, or is it good for kind of all over pain? And frequently you're giving it when you are using it for all over pain or, you know, systemic pain issues. It doesn't necessarily work better at the site where you inject it, because again, you're still using the same intramuscular injection sites you would normally. So sites like the deltoid, the butt, upper thigh, things like that, right? So you're not going to inject it. So if I have a broken forearm, I might kind of punch you if you try to inject me right in the forearm with some Toradol. So it doesn't necessarily work any better. But I will tell you, a lot of people will, you know, especially if you have patients who are coming in and they are saying, oh, I'm in such bad pain. I need my Dilaudid. I need my morphine, whatever it happens to be. Sometimes people will get away with saying, well, I got a shot for you. Let me give you some of this really good stuff. It's called Toradol. And so if they're not too privy to different pain medications, you can give a shot of that and they'll feel right as rain, right? Without having to give them any actual opioids. So that's a trick that some people will try. Most people who are experienced pain seekers will have already known that trick already. They said, no, thank you. I'll take my Normazoline to go. Okay. It's funny. I said that Normazoline joke to, you guys know what that means, right? Normal saline. So you say, I'm gonna give you a dose of Normazoline and make you feel better. Yeah, so I said a bunch of pharmacy students, and they're like, oh, Normazoline, I've never heard of that drug. I'm going to look that up. And it's like, no, it's just normal. It's just salt water. That's all it is. But patients don't know that, so they feel better. Okay, so the next group we'll talk about, spend a lot of time on these, are going to be our opioids. So do you guys know what kind of plant this is? The poppy plant, right? So the milk of the poppy, this is where I get our opioids from, at least our naturally occurring ones. And so these, again, are going to be plant-based. We'll see that we have natural occurring opioids. We'll see that as we have gone on through time, we've gone more synthetic with the chemical structure of them. And we'll see that we have some that vary very differently from the actual chemical structure. We won't get too much into that, but that'll be important. We're talking about side effects and cross-reactions for allergies and whatnot. We were actually thinking about the structure of these drugs. We know that they're going to be binding to opioid receptors, and so the three main ones you run into are going to be the mu, kappa, and delta opioid receptor. They're all going to have different activities, so we'll talk about what those are in a little bit. And you might see some newer nomenclature, call them OP1, 2, or 3. So if you see that, that's kind of what they're referring to. And these are going to be better served for treating more moderate to severe pain. You know, usually you're not going to use this for, hey, I stubbed my toe, can I have an opioid? But if toe got chopped off, then you might use that. So where are these actual opioids working? Well, we said things like NSAIDs that are working more peripherally, they're gonna be working at the site of inflammation, right? So they're working right where we're having all those inflammatory cytokines happening. But the opioids, they're typically gonna be working more in the spinal cord. So we're seeing during the spinal tracts that by inhibiting or by activating those opioid receptors, you kind of decrease the amount of signaling that gets back up into the CNS. So by working the spinal cord, and it also works centrally up in the brain to inhibit the effects of pain. So I've never taken a whole lot of opioids. I think I took like Darvocet when I had my wisdom teeth taken out as a kid or something. But the way someone described it to me is that you still know you're having pain, you just don't really care so much. Right, so it doesn't like completely obliterate the any pain that you're having, but you're just less concerned with it, or you're not really so much aware of it. So looking at the different receptors and how they work, the mu receptor is where we're going to get the majority of our benefit from, right? So this is the main one we're going to be seeing the majority of side effects and positive effects from. When activating the mu receptors, they can work to inhibit transmission by decreasing second messengers like cyclic AMP in the dorsal spinal cord and also these receptors in the brain. So by activating this, this is where we see the analgesia. This is where we see also the respiratory depression, which is one of our principal side effects we're worried about. And then also the euphoria that you get from abusing opioids. We also have the kappa receptors, which can provide some analgesia, but it can actually have some dysphoria. Which dysphoria, how would you describe that?
Confusion?
The euphoria is like, I'm feeling really good. Like dysphoria would be like, I'm feeling crappy. So kind of think about it like that. It's really kind of just a negative feeling from abusing the drugs. And then also some dissociative effects where you kind of have some mind out of body kind of experiences. And then some of the delta effects are going to be some analgesia, but here you can actually see some proconvulsant effects. We'll talk about some opioids that can actually cause seizures in specific circumstances, and also can be related to some physical dependence as well, right? So this is where we see some of the effects of tolerance, and also some of the habituation can come from some of the effects of the delta receptors. But the mu is the main one we're going to concern ourselves with for this class. So you will see that different opioids are going to have differences in binding affinity, and so this is going to account for their different physiologic effects. So some will bind very, very tightly to the receptor and will fully activate it. Some will see will only be a partial agonist at the receptor. Some will be full antagonists at the receptor. We'll talk about those. But we'll see that agonists are going to be the most commonly used drugs out there, right? Because these are the most common ones used for pain. So to go along with that, it's really important to talk about different degrees of chemical dependence and addiction that can come about from use of opioids. So it's important to understand the terminology to make sure that we can educate patients appropriately, because a lot of concerns from patients come about from getting addicted to these medications. And so if you can kind of talk through it with them and kind of educate them, you may help to limit some of those fears, try to get them the right kind of pain management. So we'll talk about physical dependence, talk about addiction, tolerance, and pseudo-addiction. So those are kind of the four main terms we'll mention here. So when I say physical dependence, what do I mean by that, do you think?
The body stops producing effects on its own and relies on the medication since it's getting it from outside source.
Yeah, so essentially when you have drugs being administered to the body, your body kind of wants to maintain homeostasis, right? So it kind of gets back to a new normal at that point. So if I always have opioids around, your body kind of gets regulated to that, to where it's like, okay, I'm used to these effects. And so a lot of it's related to mu receptor pharmacology. You're going to have differences in the expression of those receptors. So if I'm always activating mu receptors, what are they going to do? Upregulate or downregulate? Typically downregulate, right? And so when you remove the effects, because these are naturally occurring receptors, our body produces natural endorphins that activate these receptors. When you pull away that drug effect all of a sudden, now you have fewer receptors to activate, and then you run into these withdrawal phenomenon. And so is it possible to die from opioid withdrawal? I think yes.
Not.
You cannot. Very, very infrequent. They will wish that they were dead. They will not die. So when you end up stopping these opioids, you end up seeing things like nausea, vomiting, sweating, dysphoria that comes about, but not fatal, right? They're not really going to have any kind of withdrawal seizures like you may see from something like a benzodiazepine or from alcohol. So it's not fatal, but they're going to feel really, really, really bad. And this will be the same phenomenon we run into when we talk about our antagonists. So we talk about our reversal agents a little bit later on in this lecture. We know this is a frequent and expected occurrence, and this is going to be related to the chronicity of use. So the longer you're using these opioids for a chronic period of time, the more likely you are to develop this physical dependence, right? And the more likely you are to have these withdrawal effects when you come off of it. Again, a lot of it's related to dose as well. So the larger doses you're on for a longer period of time, the harder you're going to withdraw when you decrease or go cold turkey off of those drugs. Yeah, so it takes time. So it takes time for those receptors to start to upregulate again and kind of get back to a new normal for your body, or to reach back to that state of homeostasis, right? So it takes time, but eventually they can get back to that. But this is where we run into a lot of problems with addiction, to where people do not want to feel like this, and so they end up relapsing very frequently and will try to get more medication in order to help stave off this withdrawal. So again, physical dependence is expected. We know about it, but it's not necessarily going to be correlated with addiction. So addiction, on the other hand, this is a more psychological dependence, not necessarily all physical dependence, but psychological in nature. And so the best way to describe addiction is going to be continued use of the drug despite harm, whether it be harm to the patient, harm to other people. They are using this drug despite the apparent negative effects it's having on them or others. And so characteristics of that can include things like impaired control of drug use. So again, you prescribe one pill every 6 hours, but they end up taking it once every 2 hours, right? Compulsive use, so they're always trying to seek out and find more drug in order to help maintain their use, and this craving that comes about from that, right? And so we see addiction with lots of different types of drugs, but opioids can be a very prominent one that you'll run into, especially if you're working in ERs and things like that, where you have people who are definitely addicted. They've run out of their source of medication, and now they're coming in attempting to get new prescriptions for pain medications. So why does this occur? We'll talk about this slide a little bit more when we get to talking about things like schizophrenia and whatnot. But the important point I'm mentioning here is looking at this kind of neuron tract here in the brain, and basically what you end up seeing is that here in the frontal cortex, I used the wrong thing here, laser pointer. All right, basically up here in the frontal cortex, this is where a lot of things like speech, this is where your main motor functions come from, saying like, I would like to get more drugs or whatever it happens to be. And a lot of it is related to specifically these dopamine receptors. This is part of the reward pathway within the brain where if I activate those dopamine receptors, that is associated with a pleasurable experience. This is something I would like to keep doing over and over again, like having a nice big hamburger or whatever it happens to be. You want to keep that feeling going, right? And so this is where a lot of the addiction comes from. And you can look back here, you can kind of see where these mu receptors are working. This kind of goes back to working on these different inhibitory kind of neurons. So normally, if I have my mu receptor here, which is going to have an inhibitory effect on these receptors by inhibiting the amount of GABA that's being released from this neuron, this is going to make this dopamine neuron fire more frequently, right? Because it's lost that kind of inhibitory effect from GABA. So by firing this dopamine neuron more frequently, I'm hitting that reward complex more frequently, thus developing that addiction. So that's kind of where that's coming from. Again, it's more complicated than that, but this is kind of good enough for our purposes. So we'll also talk about tolerance. And so if you could describe tolerance, what do you think that is?
You need to increase your dose to get the same effect.
Absolutely. So you need to keep increasing your dose in order to maintain the same effect from the drug. And so we see that basically it's a state of adaptation, which the effects of the drug diminish over time. So the main thing you're going to see diminish over time is going to be the analgesia, right? So if you're looking at, say, you know, someone who is opioid naive versus someone who, you know, someone who's never taken opioids before versus someone who is, say, end-stage cancer patient, and you look at the relative doses of opioids, you're going to see that the cancer patient is on way higher doses, probably doses high enough that would probably kill the opioid naive person if they took even one dose of that, right? This is where you run into problems where you can have 80-year-old grandmas who are taking enough dose, you know, enough opioids in order to kill an elephant, right? But because of this tolerance over time, they develop this, and so they make it so that that's just their normal dose now, right? And so analgesia is a big one that gets some effects to this. You'll see that some of the side effects that we talk about will never have any kind of tolerance that gets developed. So especially things like constipation, that never goes away, right? You're always going to develop that constipation, can always get worse as you increase the dose. Things like respiratory depression, you can end up getting some degree of tolerance to that, but at some point, you know, you're going to start to lose that, and you can run into issues where patients are taking doses to maintain their analgesia, but not realizing they're kind of bypassing that point where they're starting to have respiratory depression, and they can run into some problems there. So just be aware that you will not have tolerance to all effects of the drugs, but mainly the therapeutic ones is where we're going to see the most tolerance here.
Can we do like drug holidays and stuff? Like how long do you have to be off of it to reset and get the analgesia?
That depends on the person, how long they're using it, how big of a dose they're using it. What's the problem though if you know, if someone who has active chronic pain, give them a drug holiday, you have a lot of pain. Also, they could go into a withdrawal from not having the medications on board and things like that. So it could be something where you end up tapering over a long period of time. So say, for instance, when we have our neonatal abstinence syndrome babies in the NICU, right? So mom's abusing opioids throughout the pregnancy. Kid comes out. They still need to have those opioid effects around. Otherwise, they're going to be withdrawing, right? Which makes it very difficult for them to maintain their blood pressure and their temperature and all kinds of other problems. And so we end up putting them on a weaning protocol, where essentially we'll put them on a dose of, say, methadone, which we'll see is a long-acting opioid, and gently titrating their dose down over a long period of time, sometimes over weeks, in order to help keep them from withdrawing. So you can kind of help taper that down, but if they're still needing like the analgesic effects, you're going to lose that if you put them on like a drug holiday. Right, but eventually they could come off of it. They could kind of regain, go back to their baseline, and be at a point where you know a normal dose of drug would deal with their pain. You know, it's a possibility. It's just rarely done. Okay, and there's also this idea of pseudo tolerance that can develop, and so basically this would be more related to either increased activity or disease progression, where basically they're having a change in their pain state, where their pain might have been well regulated beforehand, but now that say they're being more active, or their disease has progressed to a point now where their pain is higher than what their analgesia has really been designed to treat, and so you may need to adjust based on that. And their pseudo addiction, anyone? Take a guess at what pseudo addiction is. Kind of like addiction, right? Sort of, it's kind of quasi-addiction. No. So this is oftentimes, you see this associated with patients who exhibit pain-seeking behavior or drug-seeking behavior where they're coming in trying to get more drugs than what they've been prescribed. Oftentimes this can be related to under-treatment. So essentially if they have been prescribed kind of doses that are too low to treat their pain, or say they only have medication that's immediate release for breakthrough pain, but they don't have anything for around the clock or something like that. Basically the behavior is going to correct itself once they get their pain adequately treated, right? And so the best way to stave off addiction for a lot of these patients is to make sure their pain is adequately treated, to make sure they're not seeking out more medication than what they've actually been given. So it should not be confused with addiction, but how easy is it, do you think, to tell between someone who's truly addicted and someone who is having their pain undertreated?
Looks the same in the ER,
right? They're all going to say the same thing. Oh, I'm in so much pain. Please give me something. Please, please. And so it can be easy to mistake one for the other and not give them anything, right? And so this is going to be a big problem for patients who have legitimate pain issues. Just like I said, some pharmacies, they will not prescribe or they will not dispense opioids, especially controlled substances, C2s, the highest controlled substance. They'll say, nope, I'm just not going to do it. And so, oftentimes the patients have trouble finding the one pharmacy that will actually fill them for their, extremely high doses of opioids, but they've been treating this chronic pain for 15 years. They can't help, they have all this tolerance. So there can be lots of issues associated with this, and it's very difficult to tell when patients are being truthful with you. And as we say in the tox world, how do you know if a patient's lying? Their lips are moving. A little bit more of a cynical view than we probably should have, but. Anywho, so how can you tell the difference? So some things that can kind of help you delineate between addiction and appropriate use. So one, addicts typically lose function as time goes on. Their life is consumed with getting their next fix or their next dose of the medication. So they lose function over time versus someone who is not addicted will regain function. They'll be able to have a better kind of work capacity or be able to get around better. Again, we know that physical dependence is going to occur, so it should be expected for patients, anyone on long-term opioid therapy. And then the actual incidence of addiction is going to vary pretty widely depending on the type of population you're on, right? So people, if you're looking at, say, like a homeless population versus someone who, looking at a very affluent population, the addiction rates could vary pretty significantly. It's hard to really pin down the specific number in a lot of cases. So, what is one way that you can look to see if your patient is shopping around for pain medication? So, have you guys ever heard of eForce? Okay, when you get a license, sign up for this. Especially if you're going to work in an emergency department or pretty much anywhere where you might be prescribing opioids, sign up for eForce. This is actually, Florida is really late to the game in getting one of these prescription monitoring programs. This is a really great thing where basically, anyone who's prescribed an opioid that gets filled at a pharmacy, the pharmacies are mandated to report this information out to this eForce program. And so healthcare providers can go in, they can look up their patient and see just where their patient has filled these different medications, right? And so it's very easy to have a patient who comes in saying, like, oh, I need a prescription for my Percocet, I ran out, blah, blah, blah. It's easy to take in a printout and say, like, well, you just filled 200 like 2 days ago at this Walgreens, like, where are they at? Hard to refute stuff like that, right? So it can be very useful, or it can be nice to say, like, if you think someone's pain-seeking and their stuff comes up clear, that might lead you to say, okay, well, I can maybe have a little bit more trust in this person. Maybe I might prescribe them something, right? So did I mention the lady at Nemours who was having back pain issues? She's having kidney stones. So, happened several months ago, but essentially I come into the ER to work and I see this lady who's, say, in her 30s. And I'm like, we don't take care of adult patients at the children's hospital. Normally what happens is they'll come into the ER, we will ship them out to an adult facility, and we'll stabilize them there at the hospital if we need to. So if you had someone who's coded, we'll do CPR and all that good stuff and then get them shipped out to the adult facility. This lady, on the other hand, happened to be coming in with, she was visiting her child who was up on the floor and ended up having this just terrible back pain, horrible pain due to her recurrent kidney stones. So anyway, so she comes down, ends up getting managed there. She's allergic to everything except for Dilaudid, so the pediatrician prescribed Dilaudid for her. They do like a urinalysis, there was a little bit of blood on there, so it looked pretty legitimate. And so I realized this is actually the second time she's done this while at the hospital. And so I said, well, let me look up her eForce real quick. So put in her information. Sure enough, had about 10 different addresses, 10 different birthdays, all the same name, but filled at probably 40 different pharmacies within the past like 6 months, right? So I went and showed it to the provider, and they're just like, oh, I thought they were for real. Like, their pain seems so legitimate. I was like, yeah, they get pretty good at lying about this kind of stuff. There was blood in the urinalysis. Like, did you check her fingers? Sometimes they'll actually prick their fingers in order to help fake the UA. She's like, oh, well, I'm not giving her anything else, and she'd already gotten like three doses of Dilaudid. But but anywho, so people, they're very good at tricking you. They're very good at playing at your emotions. They're very good at faking their pain, so it's very difficult to tell if they're really having the truth. This is one good way to go back in there and see whether or not they've actually been, you know, filling at various different pharmacies throughout the state. So very good program. Definitely recommend all of you sign up for it once you graduate. Okay. Yes.
State by state.
It is state by state. Yeah, so if they were to go out of state, they would not show up for Florida's E-Force. But most states end up having a prescription drug monitoring program out there. Some are much more robust than Florida's is. Like I said, Florida's really late to the game, had to be like privately funded for a while before it became, yeah, it was, we're kind of a backwards state when it comes down to it. Hate to tell you guys. Huh?
It's not like we're Mississippi or anything.
Yeah, not, definitely not like Mississippi or Southern Alabama or anything like that. Yeah. Anyway. So going back into opioids, so I'm sure you guys are aware of federal scheduling of narcotics. So again, narcotic is really referring to anything that is considered to be of abuse potential, of potential for addiction. And so you'll see there's different scheduling of medications. There's C1 through 5. And so, because does anyone know what a C1 means?
Highly addictive.
No medical.
No medical use. That's the other key point. So it's highly risk for abuse, and it's of no medical use. So can you think of any examples of, heard one?
Heroin.
Marijuana is technically a Schedule 1 substance. Heroin, is that a Schedule 1?
No.
Heroin is Schedule 1. Yeah, heroin is Schedule 1.
Can
you think of any other ones? What about cocaine? Do you think cocaine is...
Yeah,
cocaine actually has a medical use. Where do you see cocaine being used?
The eyes.
The eyes, yeah, so ENT surgery, you'll sometimes see it being used. So yeah, so cocaine would actually be a Schedule 2. So Schedule 2 just means you have a high abuse potential, but it is has an accepted medical use. So things like your morphines, things like your oxycodones and Dilaudids, they're all going to be C2s, right? And then as you get down through 3 through 5, that's where you get... fewer restrictions on the medications, there's less abuse potential, so to speak, and so they have less rigorous controls on them. So you can kind of think of 3 through 5s as being kind of very similarly handled. You will see that there are certain regulations on how often you can write prescriptions for them or how much you can write for. C2s being the most kind of well-controlled because they are believed to have the highest abuse potential. So federally, medical marijuana is actually a Schedule 1 substance, considered to have no medical use. But at the state level, this is where they're starting to come in and say, like, okay, we're going to let you know, let this be used for different medical purposes. We'll talk about that a little bit later on in this lecture. But just be aware that federally, they can set different things to be Schedule 1 and Schedule 2 and all of that. But state-wise, they can also have their own list. And so very frequently, it goes back to whoever has the more stringent controls, which in a lot of cases could be the states, but in some cases could be the feds, like, you know, you'd see with the medical marijuana. So technically, the government could come in and say, like, hey, we're going to stop all this medical marijuana because it's a control, you know, Schedule 1 substance, but they just choose not to, right? So I'm sure someday down the road, it'll be just completely taken off the list, but we'll see where that goes. So, so I mentioned some C2s already there, what some examples of those are. And so we'll look at different medications. We'll kind of see where they fall in the categories of the controlled scheduling.
For the marijuana, didn't they have like a THC pill that they would give like cancer patients or to stop the nausea
mm-hmm.
and help them eat?
Yep.
That wasn't like a federally accepted medication?
Yeah, it was a federally accepted medication. It was FDA approved. We'll talk all about that. Yeah. Coming attractions. Okay, so the first one we're going to talk about is going to be codeine. Codeine is very frequently compounded with acetaminophen. So where you hear Tylenol number 3, this is what it's referring to. So codeine itself is not an active drug. It actually has to be converted within the liver over into morphine. This is done via a CYP enzyme, 2D6 specifically. So this is a very good enzyme to remember when talking about opioids. So you will see that some patients are going to have less effective 2D6 enzymes. Some people are going to be more rapidly metabolizing have more rapidly metabolizing copies of CYP2D6. So as you might imagine, if you have a patient who, say, is deficient in 2D6, how much of that codeine gets converted over to morphine? A little bit, a lot of it? Just a little bit, right? So how good do you think it is for analgesia? Not great. On the other hand, if you have rapidly metabolized CYP2D6, how much of that gets converted to morphine?
Too much.
a lot more, right? Perhaps too much, as we'll see in some cases. So we'll see some issues where this is falling out of favor, especially in pediatric patients. But certainly it's less potent than morphine, because again, morphine, you're given the active component already, but you can see it being used for more mild to moderate pain. And actually, based on how it's formulated, it could be anywhere between a C5 or potentially a C3. But very frequently, it's you'll see it being compounded with Tylenol in this Tylenol number 3. So generally avoid codeine if possible because of recent black box warnings related to patients who have ultra rapid CYP2D6 enzymes. And so what they were seeing is that patients who were having tonsillectomies and adenoidectomies, what happens to their airway typically after surgery? Likes to swell, right? Just like anything does after surgery. And so if you had kids who were already having obstructive sleep apnea, now their airway is a little bit more swollen, and now I give them an opioid that they're converting over into morphine, and one of the big side effects we'll talk about is respiratory depression. Had some deaths associated with that. Specifically, kids of Middle Eastern and North African descent were more likely to have ultra-rapid metabolizing CYP2D6, and those are the ones that where they saw the actual deaths occur. So because of this, we actually removed it completely from formulary at Nemours. We don't prescribe it for anyone. But it's kind of interesting if you think about it. What type of patients are more likely to develop sickle cell disease? African Americans, right? So as you might imagine, like they were more likely to have ultra-rapid metabolizing CYP2D6 enzyme. And so very frequently you'd see them being prescribed Tylenol number 3 for kind of chronic management of their pain issues. And that kind of makes sense when you think about the fact that they're more likely to have that phenotype. They're more likely to make more codeine or more morphine out of that than say, a Caucasian patient would. So because of that, that kind of makes sense as to why you might choose that drug for that particular situation than others. But in general, it was probably good to avoid this drug altogether. We have better options out there. Then we have morphine. So again, these are very naturally occurring opioids. So these are things that are very much derivatives off of the poppy plant. So opium, heroin, codeine, morphine, these are all very similar in structure to one another. And this is where you'll see the cross-reactivity with allergies occur. So especially things that are very similar in structure to the original opium, they have cross-reactivity to where if you have an allergy to, say, morphine, you may also have an allergy to something like, you know, codeine. That makes sense because it actually gets converted over into morphine. So we'll talk a little bit more about that as we go forward. But morphine has lots of different forms available. Certainly IV is good for acute pain issues, but we'll also have oral versions available, and immediate release, extended release, all kinds of things are available there. And so this one gets metabolized in the liver via glucuronidation, and so it actually produces these metabolites. They actually have their own activity. And so the big one to focus on here is going to be this morphine 6-glucuronide actually has greater analgesic property than morphine does itself. And so what you end up seeing is that these metabolites get cleared renally. And if you have a patient with poor renal function, they end up accumulating these things. And so you end up having these older patients who have poor renal function who accumulate this morphine 6-glucuronide and saw increased risk of sedation and respiratory depression. So again, this might be a good one to avoid in patients who have kidney issues, especially if they're going to be on it for a long period of time due to those effects. The other big thing you see as well with morphine is histamine release. So it's very frequent that you'll see patients who either have flushing or pruritus associated with especially IV doses of morphine. You can either pre-treat with an antihistamine, something like diphenhydramine to avoid this, or switch over to an agent that does not have so much histamine release. We'll talk about some other options out there. Again, this is cheap, it's very effective, and will work for many patients out there. Moving on, we are starting to get into our semi-synthetic opioids now. So these are agents that were man-made, that were kind of derivatives off of the things like heroin and codeine and morphine. And so the first one here is hydrocodone, very frequently one of the top selling drugs in America. Lots of prescriptions written for this. And so before it used to be Lortab, now I think like Norco is probably the brand name that's preferred. A lot of it is based on the amount of acetaminophen that it had in it. So does anyone know what happened to the acetaminophen amount in things like Lortab?
Went down,
right? Yeah, because before it used to be like, say, Lortab 5500, where you'd have 500 milligrams of acetaminophen. Nowadays, it's all 325. And a lot of it is to limit the amount of acetaminophen these patients are getting, to limit the hepatic toxicity that could occur. So that's really the big thing, big change you saw there recently. Rarely do you find hydrocodone by itself, but there is one that's like Zohydro extended release that's good for kind of chronic pain management. This one actually has like 50 milligrams of hydrocodone in it versus, say, something like 5 that you would normally take. So very, very potent drug. And this one actually gets converted within the liver via 2D6 over to dilaudid or hydromorphone. So hydrocodone gets converted to hydromorphone. We'll see where oxycodone gets converted to oxymorphone. It's kind of the very similar pathway there. But certainly there is less risk here than you saw with patients taking codeine, but still a little bit of risk where patients who are rapid metabolizing may have increased analgesic effects from this drug versus patients who have limited enzyme may not have a whole lot of effect. And so you can start to see where why some patients might do better with one drug versus another, and it could be related to how they metabolize it. This drug used to be a C3, controlled substance schedule 3, but now it actually got bumped up to C2. Does anyone know why that was? All the abuse that was going on with this. Remember all the pill mills that were going on? There, you know, people were dispensing just hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of pills of Lortab. And so in order for the government to have a little bit more control over it, they bumped it up to a C2, which means, you know, things like you cannot have electronic transmittal of prescriptions. You have to have a hard copy prescription you have to take into the pharmacy to get filled now. You know, limited to how much, you know, how many months worth of the medication you can get and things like that. So a lot more strict controls on it, which is certainly a problem for patients who were, you know, seeking out hydrocodone illicitly, but also for patients who have legitimate pain issues who are taking this legitimately can have issues getting the normal amounts that they were getting before. So kind of a double-edged sword there. Another very popular one is going to be oxycodone. So if you see this mixed with acetaminophen, it's going to be Percocet. If you see it by itself, it's either roxycodone, which is the immediate release, or OxyContin, which is the extended release. So you guys heard of the OxyContin Express, which we were kind of the last stop on. You know, everyone come down to the pill mills and get their OxyContin. So this one is mainly available in a oral dosage form. So I don't really see any IV forms of either hydrocodone or really oxycodone available. Notice that this one is twice as potent as morphine, and this is an important point to consider, is that all these drugs have different potencies. And so that's really important when you're converting a patient from one drug to another, and we'll look at some of those conversions as we get a little bit farther on in this lecture. Like I mentioned, this one is metabolized by 2D6 over into oxymorphone, which is the active kind of analgesic there. And again, may have some deficiencies for patients. They have less effect for those that are deficient in 2D6, so just be aware of that. Okay, then getting into the actual derivatives, you have hydromorphone or dilaudid. This one is certainly available orally, but more frequently you see this being used IV. It's a very, very potent IV analgesic when giving this one. It has a fairly short half-life as well, so this is better for kind of acute pain issues. You don't really see any kind of long-acting forms of this like you would say with the parent drug hydrocodone. But this is also a good one if you have patients who cannot tolerate morphine due to things like the pruritus or the flushing. So this is good because it has less histamine release associated with it. Okay, and so we actually see seeing a lot more growing use of this. I see a ton of hydromorphone use, especially in the hemonc population. I see a lot of this being used because, again, they are on usually so many medications. It's nice to have one that doesn't, you know, interfere with anything else and doesn't really have any issues with, you know, say, the histamine release and all that. Yes. So all of these are going to be C2 at this point. So really, codeine is the one. Opioid that is not considered a C2, all the rest of these are going to be C2s. Yeah, good question. Thank you. So next we have fentanyl. Fentanyl is a very, very good drug. I use this quite a bit in the emergency department. This one is going to be a fully synthetic opioid. So this one actually doesn't share any kind of chemical structure. And I tried to spare you guys because I knew it'd be 8 o'clock in the morning showing you chemical structures. This one is fully synthetic. It's very, very potent, about 100 times more potent than you see with morphine. And so you notice that, you know, say, a typical, you know, IV dose of morphine, say 2 to 5 milligrams, right? Here you're giving micrograms of the drug because it's so much more potent than you see with something like morphine. So be very careful with your doses. I remember one time, you know, when you're working in an electronic medical record, you know, you typically will have like your dose field where you put in how many, you know, blank milligrams or blank micrograms, and then very frequently you'll have the second box will be, you know, milligrams per day or micrograms per kilogram per day or something like that. And so I actually had a doc who meant to write in 50 micrograms but forgot to change it and ended up saying 50 micrograms per kilogram, you know, per whatever. And I was just like, he probably does not want to give 2 milligrams of fentanyl to this patient. I might call him and get, he's like, oh, holy crap, and thank you for fixing that. So just be aware when you're dealing with different doses, like there's going to be a wide range of doses you're going to give when dealing with these different drugs. This one's nice because it has lots of different dosage forms available. This is actually the fentanyl lollipop, or Actique, for chronic pain patients. They can just sit there and just kind of suck on their lollipop. Can't imagine any kid that would want to get into that, right? Having a 7-month-old, I know they want to get into everything. So that would be a big problem around my house. But lots of formulations. So certainly IV is a big place where it gets used very frequently. So there's transdermal as well. So if you ever see the Duragesic patches, that's a transdermal formulation that would slap on to their skin, and they actually get a nice controlled release of opioids throughout the day. So that actually gets dosed in micrograms per hour. So you actually see that once it gets up to once it gets to a steady state, it's releasing that many micrograms for the duration of the actual time the patch is there. So, and if you were thinking about which one of these would have the fastest duration or the fastest onset of action, how would you compare, say, like the IV versus the transdermal?
IV would be much faster.
Much faster. How long do you think the transdermal works? How quick? It could take 24 hours or so for that drug to really start to permeate through the skin in order to get to the bloodstream, right? So remember that something like a transdermal patch is good for long-term control of opioids or long-term control of pain, but you need to let it work first, right? You can't just say, say you had a patient who was on the inpatient side, you were giving them a continuous infusion of fentanyl. You can't just turn off the continuous infusion, slap a patch on, and say I'm done, because they're going to start to go into withdrawal, or they'll start to have their pain come back. But instead, if you can put the patch on, say 24 hours before you cut off the drip, that way you give them a better transition time frame there.
Would the intranasal be just as fast as the IV?
So yeah, so intranasal I wanted to point out here as well. So this is actually a growing use for fentanyl, at least for me in the peds ED. A lot of times getting IVs on kids can be very difficult. Sometimes you don't want to necessarily have to get an IV if you don't have to. So we can actually use intranasal fentanyl. Basically you have an atomizing device that goes on the end of the syringe, and you basically just kind of squirt half your dose in each nostril. And it works very, very well. Slower than you'd see with IV, because again, it takes time to cross that mucous membrane, but still works very, very well. Very nice if you don't have an IV access.
When we were talking about patch toxicities in the last semester, you made a joke about people smoking fentanyl patches.
Mm-hmm.
Is that actually a risk? Do they actually smoke them?
Yeah, people have tried smoking them before. So if you had to compare, say, like IV administration of a drug versus inhaled administration, which one do you think hits the brain faster?
Inhaled.
Think the inhaled? Why? So think about it, if you inject something IV, where does it have to go to get to the brain? So first it has to get back to the right side of the heart, and then it has to go to the
lungs,
and then it goes back to the left side of the heart, and then it can get to the brain, right? If you give something via inhalation, something like, say, crack cocaine, it gets absorbed very quickly from the lungs,
left side of the heart,
right back to the brain. So oftentimes you'll see onsets faster for inhaled drugs than you would see for an IV-administered drug. And that's also consequently more addictive, because you get a bigger spike in dopamine. So if you smoked a Duragesic patches, they would get a very, very big dose, kind of all at once, because those patches have a lot more drug in there than just what you get over the actual duration of action, because it's all diffusion related. But you get a very big dose, and they have this kind of rapid knockdown effect where they're basically just comatose.
When is the I'm worried about the heat, like breaking down the drug.
You may have some breakdown of the drug, but apparently they are still able to get some effect from it. I don't know. Heat's another big problem for the Duragesic patches as well. So imagine if you have lower back pain, you slap it on, and you say, I'm going to go into the jacuzzi. Heat will also increase the dispersal of the drug and increase the flux across the skin. So you have patients where, or cases where patients were either heating the pads with like a heating pad, or they went to a jacuzzi or something like that, and ended up getting severe toxicity based on that. Like a case report of someone who's tried to commit suicide by putting a bunch of patches on, taking a blow dryer, and trying to increase release that way. Very odd ways people use these drugs. But anywho, but yeah, intranasal is a really good route of administration if you don't have IV access, and good for acute pain management. There's a couple of congeners to fentanyl. So this is kind of my dad is as dorky as I am as a CRNA. He calls these the fentanyl family. So he talks about Al, Sue, and Remy. And so we basically have alfentanyl, sufentanyl, and remifentanyl. all of which are very, very potent opioids that work very similarly, but you mainly only see them being used in the surgical setting. So when patients are under general anesthesia, this is where you mainly see these drugs being used. Not really good for acute pain situations, say for acute pain management when the patient's awake, this is really during the surgical setting. And again, these drugs work very, very, very short duration of action, which is nice because, you know, if you imagine a patient who's under general anesthesia for surgery, you want something that they can come out of very quickly. So that there being a short duration of action is a good thing for these drugs. And so fentanyl is very good because if you have a fully synthetic drug, very frequently if they have an allergy to something like morphine, they can take fentanyl with no problem. There's not really going to be any cross-reactivity there, which is nice. Something like a hydrocodone, which is semi-synthetic, still can share some structural similarity to morphine, so there might be some cross-reactivity. So a patient who is morphine allergic might still have a reaction to hydrocodone, but something like fentanyl, they're safe to take. And so most of the ones we'll talk about from here on out are fully synthetic. You don't really have any risk of cross-reactivity there. And again, just to kind of give you a comparison here, so you look at something like heroin on the left here versus or morphine, you'll notice they're very, very similar in structure versus fentanyl, looks nothing like it. So you can imagine how the body has a hard time kind of cross-reacting between those two different chemical structures. I used to have a heroin addiction. I was addicted to ladies that save lives. It was a pretty tough one to break. Anyway, it's a good one. Okay. Make sure you guys are still awake. Okay, so the next drug we'll mention here is going to be methadone. And so this one, you guys have heard of methadone before. Where do you use methadone mainly? Methadone clinics. Methadone clinics, yep. Whole clinics just dedicated to one drug, right? What are methadone clinics used for?
Opiate withdrawal.
Yeah, kind of all around. So again, opioid addiction is basically the big thing. You're trying to get people off of their addiction to opioids. So methadone is good. It has a couple of different mechanisms of action here. So it can work on all three opioid receptors, but it also has some NMDA receptor antagonism. NMDA is what type of receptor? What? What type of neurotransmitter activates it? Glutamate. The glutamate receptor. So we'll see some other drugs that inhibit this as well, but essentially it kind of provides some additional analgesic effect. NMDA antagonism is actually how the drug ketamine works as well. It leads it to be a dissociative anesthetic. We'll talk about that later. It can also have some effects to inhibit the reuptake of things like norepinephrine, serotonin, so lots of different mechanisms here. But the big thing here is that its half-life is greater than 50 hours. A very, very long half-life. And so that means that, one, it can accumulate levels over time. So it has a very nice tapering effect, especially if you're using chronic dosing. It can taper itself very nicely. Should not be used for breakthrough pain, right? Things that have shorter half-lives are good to use for acute pain or breakthrough pain, but really long-acting drugs like this are not good for that. So sometimes you'll see this being used for more chronic pain management. It's becoming more popular now that it's had more kind of experience associated with it, but originally it was mainly used for opioid addiction. And so the idea would be is that if you had someone who was, say, addicted to heroin or morphine or whatever it happens to be, you could basically give them a dose on Friday and actually allow them, you know, in all direct observed therapy, we're actually watching them take the medication. You dose them throughout the week, and then on Friday, they'll get their last dose. And then when the clinic closed on Saturday, Sunday, presumably they have levels enough, high enough, they've actually can taper over the weekend, and they'll come back Monday and get redosed again. So they're able to kind of limit the, you know, kind of give them that weekend free period where they can, you know, not have to go in those days. So other places I've seen it being used, I mentioned the neonatal abstinence syndrome babies where, you know, basically we're giving them this to them because, again, it helps with that taper to limit the withdrawal effects. Because, again, you know, if you go cold turkey off of something like a heroin addiction, it can be very, very uncomfortable for the patient, very likely to relapse. But the idea here being if you have a nice kind of slow taper, you're gently titrating the dose down, you limit those withdrawal effects and hopefully increase their chances for success. If a patient is coming into the hospital, one of the general rules is when you're doing your interview, you always half their methadone dose and double the amount they say they drink and smoke. Because again, people oftentimes lie, and so this is one of those things where this drug can be very, very dangerous because it has such a long half-life that if you goof up the dose or if someone lies to you and tells you they take a whole lot more than what they actually take, they can run into some big problems with the respiratory and CNS depression. So we had one patient my wife was responsible for over at ORMC to where they had MedRec pharmacy tax, where basically they went in and did medication reconciliation. So you know, this guy said, oh, I take, you know, so much morphine or methadone, you know, it was a really big dose, you know, four times a day. Didn't seem completely out of the question. It was just a pretty high dose. So the pharmacist had checked it off. The provider had reordered it, and sure enough, the next day they find the guy, you know, completely zonked out. You know, they were to reverse it eventually. But one of the things you have to do is check with their methadone clinic, see what they were being prescribed previously, so you don't kind of mess that up and see. You know, that eForce could help out with that as well if you were to go back and check to see what they've been dispensed previously. So that way you don't run into problems with that. So again, we'll talk about conversion ratios later, but there's lots of different conversions here, so it can be very difficult to figure out what exactly dose you should start a patient on methadone on. And then one of the unique things as well is that you can see QTC prolongation. So this might be if your patient has a pre-existing condition, may check their electrolytes or may check an EKG before using this drug. So really, it can be a very good drug, but it takes a lot of kind of careful monitoring for it to be used effectively. Another one you won't see used all that too frequently is going to be meperidine or Demerol. This should almost never be used, except for one specific situation. And so the problem with this drug is that it gets metabolized into something called normeperidine. And so for patients who are renally challenged, they will accumulate this normeperidine and can actually lead to seizures. So it's a very bad drug for the most part, not very good for analgesia. Really the only big place where it gets used is going to be for Rigors in the surgical setting. So a patient who's having, you know, Rigors associated with surgery, you can give this to them and it will help to inhibit that. Not really sure that mechanism. Some of it may be related due to things like inhibiting monoamine oxidase. So you could also see some interactions there where you have run the risk for something like serotonin syndrome. You can see some problems. So just be aware that this is really only used in the surgical setting. So if you were to see, like, you know, on a test question, or like, you know, what might be the best option for this person's acute pain, you know, they just broke their leg, and you have, like, you know, meperidine, you have transdermal fentanyl, you have, say, extended release oxycodone and intranasal fentanyl, you know, okay, well, I'm going to use the short-acting medication, intranasal fentanyl, it's going to be my option there, right? So that would be some of the kind of questions where, based on the clinical setting, what might be the best drug for this patient? Another one hopefully you won't see ever is going to be propoxyphene or Darvon. It was given with acetaminophen called Darvocet very frequently. This one's actually off the market now, but you never know when your patients might be squirreling away some of the drug, as you might see it infrequently. This ran into the same problem as meperidine, where it would accumulate a metabolite in renally insufficient patients and they'd develop seizures. You also saw risk of cardiac conduction abnormalities, and so that's why that one got pulled off of the market. So this one is not really used anymore. But just in case you see it, that's where why it was pulled off and some of the problems with it. Okay, has anyone heard of buprenorphine before, or Suboxone or Subutex? Okay, so this is a newer drug. It's kind of taken, not really taken the place, but it can be used instead of methadone in some circumstances. So this one's kind of interesting because it's a long-acting agent. You can give it via several different routes. So you can maybe give it, say, sublingually, transdermally, sometimes via implant even, where you can kind of provide long-acting release of the drug. The apparent half-life of it sublingually is around 37 hours. So it lasts a good long time, sticks around in the bloodstream. Again, provides that kind of natural taper effect that you would see with something like a methadone. The unique thing about this one is that all the other drugs we've talked about have mainly been full agonists at the mu receptors. This one has a very high binding affinity, so it binds to the receptors really tight, but it only has a partial agonist effect, right? So instead of, say, activating the receptor 100%, you may only get, say, 75% activation or, say, 50% activation. So the idea is that by having this drug around, you can dose them, and you know, it lasts a long time. So it's binding, sitting on that receptor, it's binding there really hard, and only, say, partially activating it. What happens if they were to, say, inject heroin afterwards? They shouldn't really get as much of an effect because that Suboxone or that buprenorphine sitting on that receptor preventing the heroin from actually interacting with it. That's kind of the idea behind it, is that it binds really tight there and will prevent those issues from popping up if they were to relapse and use their drug of choice. So that's why it gets used in opioid addiction. There's actually a form, the Suboxone is formulated with an antagonist called naloxone. Naloxone itself is not absorbed orally. But if you were to inject it, the idea would be is that you would get the antagonist effects from the naloxone. They'd feel so crummy from the withdrawal that they wouldn't want to abuse it anymore. It doesn't necessarily work that well, but that's kind of the idea behind doing that.
The methadone do the same thing? Does it block the receptors?
Not really. No, I mean, you could still see some additive effect. And it's still a full agonist. So, you know, if you take enough of it, you're still going to get, you know, just as much of a high as you might have off of other drugs as well. You know, this one, with it being a partial agonist, you can only see somewhat limited effects with it, even as you increase the dose, right? So that can be some issues with that. I've probably mentioned the story before, but I had one lady who apparently was coming into the ER who had overdosed on Suboxone. You guys remember that one? Probably said in pharmacodynamics or something. But anyway, lady comes in and EMS, you know, calls and says, hey, she overdosed on the Suboxone. She'll be there in 5. So she shows up, and what you would expect to see is someone who's very sedate, someone who is potentially respiratory depressed. She came in kicking, screaming, biting, yelling, in restraints, going crazy. And so the doctor like, well, what the heck's going on with this lady? Like, you know, she should be sedate right now. She overdosed on Suboxone. So after we gave her some Ativan to try to calm her down, which is a benzodiazepine we'll talk about in the neurology section, actually in the anxiety section, we were able to kind of get some history from her. And so we were like, okay, what happened? She's like, oh, I ran out of my normal stuff. So I took all my friend's Suboxone. I was like, what do you normally take? And she's like, oh, I normally take morphine. And I was like, ah, I have it now. So normally she takes morphine, which is a full agonist at those receptors. And now when she ran out, she took all of her friend's Suboxone. So by doing that, by taking that buprenorphine and only partially activating those receptors, she threw herself into withdrawal because she's used to having a full agonist effect at those receptors. Now she only has partial. And then even if we were to give her normal opioid of choice, on top of that, the buprenorphine would still be binding on that receptor, preventing it from activating it. So because of knowing the receptor pharmacology and all of that, we can get a better idea of why she comes in presenting the way she does when it's completely the opposite of what you would expect, right? This could also be a big issue, especially in children, where a kid has gotten into like a one dose of buprenorphine and has been completely sedate, had to be intubated for a prolonged period of time. So this can be very dangerous for kids to get into as well. So just be aware of that. Okay, so that's the majority of the opioids. I will go ahead and stop it here. We'll come back and not do behavioral stuff on Thursday.